Internet?
Greetings, what is up and a very warm welcome to the channel. The sun is shining and the magpie is casting. Coming to you guys right now with a little bit of just a warm-up. So this is something I'm doing. This is really just an announcement for the YouTube channel. I'm kicking up the stream just a few minutes early every day. It's like 36 minutes past 11 here, not actually midday. And I'm just going to play a game, probably with the mic off, just to rest my voice. And it's just a little bit of me getting used to like playing some games on the stream, and gives people an opportunity to just pop into the Twitch and just kind of get ready for the midday magpie proper. So yeah, I'm going to turn the mic off and it's just going to be me playing some MTGA. I'll be active in chat if anyone wants to say hi or whatever, and yeah, that's it. So if you're watching this on the YouTube, skip forward about 24 minutes, and that's where the Company of Heroes 2 will begin in earnest, and I'll see you there.
we're going to have to act if we want to live in a different world.
Greetings! What is up and a very warm welcome to the channel. The sun is hiding, because the weather is actually broken here in England. It's been cold and rainy, just like normal, recently, which is quite a change. This has been the hottest year on record since Damn Records began, so it is a bit of a change. And the magpie is casting. Coming to you guys right now with some midday magpie! We're going to be casting some Company of Heroes 2, as we like to do. Oh, that's weird. There we go. So we're going to be casting some Company of Heroes 2. This is just a new thing that I'm doing at the start of some of the streams. If I have time, I'm just going to like open the stream up maybe half an hour, maybe even more, maybe even less early, and just play a game, whatever I feel like. So this morning we just played a little bit of Magic the Gathering Arena, busted some skulls, milled some dudes, it's just a way that I can just sort of get used to playing games on the stream and interact with chat a little bit, and just kind of gives everyone a little bit of a time to sort of filter in and get ready for the midday magpie to actually begin. Good morning and welcome to those of you who are already here. A-Game, Magistern, Emma Duranke, I see you boys, thanks very much. Awesome, thanks for turning up this morning. Actually, you know what, did I just assume your gender? Sorry, I have absolutely no basis on which to make that assumption. I'm just having a look through the live game lobbies. Ooh, that's an interesting one. Ooh. Hang on now. Ooh, we've got some interesting games to choose from. We've got Skeletron versus McBain, and we've seen those players both be interesting. I think they are one rung off of being the top tier of the game. But they're both really good, and they've both given us some really entertaining games on the channel recently, so I am inclined to give that game a look. The drawback of that game is that it doesn't actually start for 6 minutes, though. So hang on, let me just have a look and see what else we've got going on. Oh no, we don't want to do that. Here we go. I'm just checking these profiles, because there's a lot of new screen names that I don't recognize here, but none of them are immediately ringing a bell. Do I also cast 2v2? No, not usually, Olvardi. I do not usually cast 2v2. I've actually got nothing against 2v2. That's something that I'm probably going to get into at some point. But the reason I don't really cast 2v2, or certainly the reason I don't cast 3v3 or 4v4, is because there's so much action going on. It's basically impossible to capture everything. And the nature of those games, as you get more players, just becomes super chaotic. And I don't really feel like, I mean, it's great to watch insofar as it's great to just see it happening, but it feels a lot less like conventional RTS, and I feel like it's much harder to sort of string together a narrative of the battle going forwards when you're missing a lot of important moments off the screen and when there's just constant chaos. I mean, even in a 1v1, there's constant action in Company of Heroes 2, but you can kind of make sense of what's going on. But once you get like 2v2, 3v3 and above, it's like crazy. Having said that, I would like to cast some high-level 2v2, yeah, because I think at 2v2 it can still be, at the high level, players do sort of coordinate and orchestrate and make cool assaults and make stuff happen, so, 2v2 at the high level, I would be interested in giving that a look for sure. Okay, sure. You can send me the link or send me the replay. It's magpiereplays@gmail.com. If you want to send that one in, that'd be cool. It was a high-level game. Well, that sounds acceptable to me. No spoilers, though, please. The less you tell me about it, the more I'll enjoy it. This is part of the reason why I really like casting live game lobbies, is because you never know what you're going to see. And even if someone sent you a replay, usually when someone sent you a replay, it's a replay that they won and they did really well in. And so you kind of already know certain things about a replay based on that, usually. So don't tell me anything about the replay. That'll be really sick. I'm just loading into this game, but it looks like there are still 3 minutes on the pre-game timer, so I guess we're just gonna hang out and chat for 3 minutes. Nothing else to do, I'm afraid. But we have got a game here between Skeletron and McBain that's gonna be coming up for you guys shortly. So thank you very much for your patience this morning. Let's have a look here. Hey, Game Anks, KOTU 2v2 was fun back in the day, but then we went on a 50 win streak and got called abusers. You went on a 50 game win streak in 2v2. Jesus. Really? Yikes. That's a lot. Nicely done. Are you sure you weren't actually abusing? Because that sounds pretty crazy. Yeah, I used to play 2v2, actually. To be honest, it might be my most played game type, because like it's a little bit less intimidating when you're trying to play the game, not cast it, to have a teammate who's there to sort of like, you know, help you out, someone who can lean on a little bit, certainly for me, because I'm not the best player. Not that I'm too bad either, but yeah, I did play a lot of 2v2 back in the day. A lot of, probably my most memorable PvP moments in Company of Heroes 2 have been 2v2 moments. Like, yeah. And I really like the 2v2 map pool as well. Now I think about it, there's some really great maps in there. They feel a lot more focused. What is that one, Rail Yard or something? The one which is like really narrow. A lot of the 2v2 maps are a sort of much more narrow affair. So you kind of, you're responsible for your strip of the front, and it's, I don't know, it's just a different dynamic to the combat, and it is really entertaining. But no, I've never been on a 50 game win streak. In fact, I don't think I've ever been called an abuser, to be honest, A-game. So, yeah, you're definitely doing something right. What's your favourite faction, A-game? Who do you prefer to play as? I'm going to guess it's Soviets. You play USF? Actually, you know what? No, that doesn't surprise me. And Wehrmacht for sure, yeah. You were terrible at Soviets. Wow. That actually surprises me. Yeah, that does surprise me. But you playing USF does not surprise me. USF are such a dynamic faction, and they just, as long as you can keep up with what they're doing, they will reward you so much. And you, my friend, can really keep up with what stuff is happening, so yeah, that makes sense to me. All right, we've got 35 seconds. We're nearly there. Nearly there on this game loading in. Thanks for bearing with me, guys. Actually, you know what? If you, those of you who are watching on Twitch live, scroll down and have a little look. I redid some of the Twitch panels down there, so we've got some interesting stuff going on there. It looks a tiny bit better, and I've actually, you know, posted a schedule and I've linked it to my Twitter and stuff like that. So, yay, that's been done. That's cool. I've switched to using Muxie now as the service provider, so we've got Muxie now for alerts and donates and stuff like that. That is all working as far as I know. Looking forward to seeing some of that occur so we can give it a test. But you know, it's time for me to stop filling the air and bring you all into this fantastic game of Company of Heroes 2. Here we go. Finally, it has begun. Spawning in the south, in the deep snow, playing as the Wehrmacht forces, selecting German infantry doctrine. It's gonna be Skeletron. And spawning in the north, playing as the United States pieces, going for the... what is this guy called? Mechanized? Armor Company, good God. Going for the Armor Company, it's gonna be McBain. I'm getting better at the American commanders, I really am. The regular streaming is helping me learn the commanders like really well, but yeah, I'm still pretty bad at like the American commanders generally. I'm still pretty bad at USF, to be honest. I can't bring myself to play them either. They're not for me. I don't get on with them somehow. All right, we've already got the Assault Engineer Squad moving out onto the field here. So McBain going to be making use of the abilities on this commander straight away. So let's have a look at these guys. 280 manpower. Not often we see them on the field. I believe they've got the little grease gun SMGs. Yep. So that was essentially a stripped down, very cheap to manufacture version of the Tommy gun, which could essentially be made just by pressing a couple of sheets of metal. A genius piece of design. Very light. And very durable, I suppose. Perfectly suited to vehicle crews, because it folds down into a tiny, tiny space. What a fantastically lethal piece of engineering. So MG42 into double grenadiers here. Pretty standard German infantry doctrine opener here for Skeletron. Going to be moving out onto the field here. Always reminded of the cold mechanics. Yeah. I'm glad that they got kicked out of the game, though, because they sounded really cool, but I'll be honest with you, they made the game miserable to play. It was just excruciating. They sounded really cool. Those snow mechanics sounded awesome, but they were, in fact, awful. They're fine for the campaign and stuff. I think they're fine there, but when you're trying to deal with another player and fight against the map, it just felt horrendous. And the amount of times that it felt like you're on the verge of victory and then your opponent gets saved by a blizzard or something, it was just like... It was too much for me to deal with. What's up, Datton? Good to see you there. Good morning to you, friend. Good afternoon, I suppose it is. Welcome aboard. Yeah, the water freezing over was cool. Until you had, like, a tank on the water and, like, somebody sneezed at your tank and it falls through the ice. I mean, like, you just basically could never, ever, ever, ever have your tanks on ice. Which I suppose is wise. I suppose that does make sense. But, I mean, it's just super frustrating. Yeah, Ko is already quite frustration heavy. I hear you. It certainly can be. Lieutenant Tech here is going to be the tech of choice for McBain. So pretty standard stuff. And that should stand them in good stead. What is this? Why have we got these ghost lines here? What is this about? I don't know what this is. That's strange. Does that? No, I literally have no idea what that is. Interesting. Looks like a regular rifleman going to be moving in here to bolster the assault engineers. Those Garands will be doing the work at close range. These grenadiers won't be able to compete with the point-blank DPS of a five-man squad with Garands, as we're used to seeing. Flamethrower finishes up on these pioneers, so Skeletron adding some DPS to the roster. And munitions are actually kind of flatlining right now. Skeletron has some grenadiers supporting, grabbing munitions point, but he has been cut off here. Grenadiers are going to scare away those riflemen, and that will enable him to reconnect the munition point. Of course, that's super critical when you're going for German infantry doctrine. Munitions are your most precious resource, essentially, at least in the for the first 10 or 15 minutes of the game. You really need the munitions to be flowing if you want to make top, if you want to get the most value out of this commander. And it's going to be a 250 half track, which we are seeing increasingly from this doctrine on the channel. So I like that. I like that. I think it's a good idea. It's really useful against all these units, and it just seems to like be like a quite a solid investment, to be honest. I always forget how much it costs. It's like 20 fuel and 210 manpower. Yeah, so surprisingly affordable, that one. Yep. So here comes the 250 half track. And remember, of course, for those of you who may not be familiar, but I'm pretty sure those of you who are tuning in at the moment, you're all seasoned veterans, but this one, you know, at one star of veterancy, it sort of basically becomes a sort of 251 half track light. Like, it's so good I can't believe it's not 251 half track kind of unit. And yeah, I think that's a pretty sweet place for this unit to be. Having the option to become a reinforcing half track is really sweet, and it does provide utility by being a sort of clown car with also that has a decent MG on it that you can hold down, and it provides suppression. So it actually is doing a lot. M5 mines are on the field though here for McBain. So that is something that assault engineers can put down, I believe. So the half track is going to have to be careful of that. No metal detector, of course, out here for Skeletron yet. And oh god, he's getting sick overrun on these rear ash. That is probably going to be a squad wipe. I can't see these rear ash surviving. Yeah, and that's the kind of thing that this 250 half track can let you do at this timing in the game. If you break a squad, it's fast. It will keep up with them on the retreat, and it, you know, with the MP40s in their current buffed state, with the flamethrower and the MG42 pintle. it actually does a lot of damage. So McBain here is going to respond by going for the Stuart-like tank, and that makes a lot of sense. That's going to be really useful here. Skeletron doesn't actually have Leicht the Mechanized Company yet, so no option for pack guns. Going to need to throw that one down soon, but this is his only Pioneer squad, and they are out fighting right now. Going to drive right on into a load of American units, taking quite a lot of damage. Probably wants to kite away here as soon as these riflemen get a star of veterancy, and they are close. The anti-vehicle grenade will be able to donk the 250 half-track, and that's not what you want. Option to hull it down there, actually. That is a reasonable position for a hull down. Not going to go for it. He manages to break that squad before the Star of Veterancy comes down. Wow, that's kind of huge. He's going to hull it down here, trying to get the suppress on these flamethrower assault engineers. Nice, actually, taking the fight. Stormtrooper's going to chip in as well, with MP40s blazing. And this is actually looking suspiciously good for our German player. German infantry doctrine kind of flexing a little bit here. Veteran squad upgrades coming down. We have one munitions point connected. So, you know, that we're able to afford these upgrades. Here comes the Stuart, though, right? And that has to turn these things around. Yeah, yeah. Pioneers have to GTFO. The 250 half-track will be focused. And now, what do you do about this Stuart? This is the problem. So here comes the reversal here. McBain ought to be able to flex a little bit now. 50 cal has been added into the roster, and that should enable the American player to control the middle of the field a little bit. Whoa, this half-track is demolishing. And it's gone. Ha! It's funny, actually. I just watched that episode of South Park, like, the other day. We're going to put your money into a money market mutual account and then reinvest it into foreign currencies with a compounding, and it's gone. Classic gold. But yeah, this Stewart is just going to be able to wreck face out on the field for some time here. And Assault Engineers going to be storming down the west flank here. And that's crucial. Going to grab this cutoff point. That's massive. We want to slash down the amount of munitions that Skeletron has access to. Skeletron is like a dedicated Wehrmacht German infantry player, isn't he? I'm not sure I've seen him do anything else over the last month or so. So that's pretty interesting stuff. I guess it kind of pays to specialize. You get really good at doing one thing. Oh, this MG42 significantly flustered. Has to get out of there, and will. No Leichter Mechanized Company, right? Oh my god. How is he? Is he going to buy Panzer Shreks? He is buying Panzer Shreks on his stormtroopers, but they're going to die. McBain. The stormtroopers, bro. Okay, so he let the Shrek finish on these stormtroopers, and they are horribly exposed. If the Stuart decides to overrun, there could be a chance of a wipe here. Actually, he's going to play it safe rather than sorry. Wow. I think perhaps if McBain actually saw the Panzer Shrek was finished on this unit, that would have been a sick moment to try and just run them down with the Stuart, because if you take out that Panzer Shrek, Skeletron is in a terrible place. Like, that might be game-ending damage after that. For whatever reason, the Stuart is actually going to play it safe and back away, and that's okay. And because of that, we get to see something resembling a normal game of Company of Heroes 2 start to unfold here. Thank you, Fox125. The stream info does say I'm still playing Magic. Ha! Thank you! I forgot to update that. Alright. Alright, we've got that updated. Thank you very much, Fox125. Nice spot. I'm still getting used to this whole Twitch thing, so sometimes things like this do fall through the cracks. I'm learning. I'm getting better. Day by day, week by week. That's what's happening here. Datton, you already think that Skeletron is in a terrible place. Yeah, I kind of agree with you. I mean, I've seen German Wehrmacht players do this like in a few games over the last month or two, and it's just like, If you opt to skip Leichter Mechanized Company, you just have to hope your opponent doesn't go for a light tank, because if they do, like, you're so boned, right? Like, this is terrible. We've got, what is this? We've got one Shrek on the Stormtroopers. That's not enough. I'm not even convinced that two squads of Stormtroopers with Shreks is enough, because, like, they're only four-man squads. They can get focused down by all this American infantry. Like, no worries. Actually, we're up to double 50 cal. Or did he steal the MG42? No, it's double 50 cal. Nice. I really like that. That's brutal. And, like, it's trivial for the Stuart to just... If the Stuart wants to just not fight where these guys are, that's fine. The Stuart can just, like, be like, oh, I see your stormtroopers are over there. I'm going to dive down the other flank and just inflict grievous damage. But anyway... Skeletron has saved some fuel by not building the Leichter Mechanized Company. And we're going to spend that fuel to get a relatively early support armor core here. Now, we've got 56 fuel in the bank right now. Obviously, not enough for a choice. In fact, we're many minutes away from making a choice, so... He's still in jeopardy. I mean, this early-ish support armor core is actually not value by itself. You need to build a unit from it. And the way things are looking, I feel like you might even be forced to get a Stug G. Nothing wrong with that, of course, but I mean, we are feeling... It does look like he's going to be forced to get a Stug G. And that is basically because it's a pack gun that also costs 90 fuel. It does a lot of other things. It's really useful, I grant you. But right now, what we need is a way of dealing with the Stuart. And a pack gun is probably that. So a Stug is essentially a pack gun, so that's pretty cool. And there's been a pretty big triple cap also established by McBain now, going on for a while, because, I mean, how can Axis forces realistically try to control any part of this battlefield when there is a Stuart and no answer? And so even if you discount the Stuart, we're up to, is that 350 cals? McBain, he's trying something new. This is new. 350 cals with Assault Engineer, Rifleman, Lieutenant. That's horrifying. Honestly, actually, on a map this small, that essentially means no matter where you are, as long as the American player spaces the MGs nicely, you're going to be fighting under the arc of a 50 cal. That's horrifying. I feel like we might actually need GR-34 at this point, because we just need the smoke to not die and the barrages to help counter those weapon teams. So, okay, Skeletron is now saving up. He's got a decent bank of manpower. He'll have the fuel in a few seconds to go for the Stug G, and I feel like it has to be the Stug G to not die here. Gonna actually connect a Faust onto the Stuart finally. That's lovely. That will buy him at least 30 or 40 seconds of Stuart free time to operate here, which is going to be really nice. That is exactly what he needed. But we still, even with catching this cutoff, the munitions point has to fall into USF hands, so not going to be able to get any munitions rolling, and we do want them rolling. We still don't have veteran squad upgrade on one of these grenadier squads. Veteran squad leader upgrade, I should say. Oh god, the stormtrooper's getting cut down to size. 50 cal in the building. Riflemen, assault engineers, who are now 3-star vet already, chipping in for damage, and the stormtroopers will be forced away, and that is the only anti-tank piece at the moment that Skeletron has. So, wow, he's definitely not going for the Stug. This is so brave. I mean, almost to the point of being foolhardy, right? Like, a Stug looks fine on this battlefield. Don't be daft and try and save for a Panzer IV, or is it going to be an Ostwin? It is an Ostwin. I don't think I even like this as much as a Stug. Yeah, the Ostwin can bully the Stuart, but I don't know. I don't know. What's up, Connex? I like pizza as well, but it's not good for me. Yeah, okay. Good call, Datton. Yeah, Skeletron does actually like Ostwins, doesn't he? And I like Ostwins too. They are cool units to see. And the Ostwin for sure is going to help against these weapon teams. But, I mean, we've already got Major Tech out. Like, your opponent's going to have a Sherman in a second. And then we're in the same problem of don't have Pat Gun, you know? So, is it not time to side tech into the Leichter Mechanized Company? Skeletron, I think you're being a bit obstinate here. You just... The idea is nice. What if we try to skip some tech and get an advantage? But that's not what's happening. We're getting punished so hard for this missing tech. Anyway, here comes the Ostwind. And if he's able to somehow get a Faust on, another Faust onto the Stuart and then perhaps overrun with the Ostwind, then maybe there's a world where he can get something done. Okay, here we go. The Ostwind's going to start putting some holes in the Stuart, but it's probably not even going to be able to kill it. I mean, the Ostwind cannot actually outrun the Stuart, and there's a lot of American support. You know, we could see... Okay, he's not going to use armor-piercing ammo, actually, because the Stuart is just going to do horrible things to this machine gun crew. Actually, if we can pick up a 50 cal, that would be so nice. The fullback is very late on this 50 cal. Wow, the pack-up time on a 50 cal is so much faster than I thought. Having seen it directly there in action, that's crazy. This guy's actually going to heroically, on a pixel, get that 50 cal out. Jeez, get that guy a purple heart. That is some insane play. Nicely done for him. So, the Ostwind... Oh my god, there are mines popping up in all kinds of places. This Ostwin has to be so careful. He's just driving around in fog of war. There's a mine here. Oh, he hits another mine. Oh god, this is just problems. And there is fuel actually for a Sherman for the American player. Or he could go for the Wolverine, which would be pretty cool to see. But I mean, I think a Sherman is honestly probably better here. And now the Ostwin has to limp away. And it's like, this Ostwin is not actually keeping you above water. Gonna reinvest, or not reinvest, gonna buy an additional squad of stormtroopers here. But we still don't really have the munitions to buy them a Shrek or anything, so this is not really a decent enough stand-in for a pack gun. How often is the M10 used? Hardly ever. Like, nearly never. I virtually never see it. Although, on the rare chances that I do, it does look fine. Oh, wow, the Stuart comes in. Oh, that is ill-advised. That is a gift from the American player. Okay, Stuart comes in. And just gets gibbed by the Ostwind. Did it hit some telemines on the way in? Because suddenly there was a lot of damage and an engine brake on that, but I only got the screen over there like just a little too late, so not actually sure. Oh no. We can't be hemorrhaging core infantry, bro. We don't have the money. We're on the ropes here, Skeletron. And yeah, the Sherman bulldozer is out now, and that is a problem. This is actually a pretty good sort of intermediate between the armor and durability of a Sherman with the utility of a Scott. I mean, this is kind of an assault gun Sherman, this one. 105mm on that thing, and it will flump your units down. This is... Actually, it's like a mini Brumbar. Look at the size of these shots. So, yeah, I mean, it's nice for you that you have a Panzer Schreck on your infantry, but unfortunately, infantry is what this bulldozer Sherman likes to blow up. Yeah, and he's going to acquire them. He's going to get a shot on the way out. He is! Oh, God, the fullback! Oh, he's going to lose the Panzer Schreck. Oh, dear. And this is all coming together to plan here for McBain. Absolutely. Absolutely running smoothly, firing on all cylinders. Oosh! And this bulldozer Sherman, I mean, it's rare that we even see the bulldozer Sherman, to be honest, in a game. 50 cal pintle mount is done, and it's just flumping Axis squads to death. There is no surviving the 105mm. And Zooks now on the lieutenant. I'd love to see weapon racks finish up for McVayne so we can put some Zooks on the Oh wow, actually, the lieutenant gets ripped up to shreds by all of this infantry in the Ospin, so he has to fall back. But and you know what? Actually, the engine on the Dozer Sherman is a bit wrecked. Have we overextended McVayne? Have we overextended? There is no Shrek on these stormtroopers. And the Sherman still has over half of its health. And if he targets this Grenadier, oh my god, Skeletron getting the fallback like exactly on time to not lose that squad. A split second later and that squad would have been lost. The Ospind is actually, look at this engine broken war here. Neither player has an AT gun to help out. So the Ospind is bravely going to keep going. If there were any mines out here, it would have been defeated. The assault engineer is going to try, but there's nothing they can do. And I think the Ospind is actually kind of winning the DPS war here. It has its second star of veterancy now, so it's actually going to start doing more DPS. Okay, here comes the lieutenant. Smoke shell going to cover him in. He wasn't reinforced, though. Okay, he should get the one Zook shot. There we go. And that's game. Wow. Oh, God. Okay, Skeletron, we can leave this game now, I think. We've got no army left. This is German infantry, ladies and gentlemen. A double-edged sword for sure. We're not seeing it win a lot of games, are we, on the channel, for what is a huge piece of the meta. And also, that Bulldozer Sherman is actually looking pretty good there, isn't it? Excuse me for one moment as I am distracted. I have some work emails have come in during the course of that game. Okay, that's brilliant. Groovy. All right. Well, let's head back to the live game lobby and see what we see. So we've got a game on Langriskaya here. Elpern. Elpern's pretty good. And Hireling. Who the hell is Hireling? Da-da-da-da-da. We don't know. We've also got a game between the Angry Dutchman and the Sloth. I would love to cast that one, but honestly, the Sloth hasn't really given us any good games, and we've cast a few. So I feel like we're going to watch this game on Langriskaya. It's also got Soviets, and that recommends it pretty highly in my books. So yep, going to make the executive decision here and jump on into that one. I'll tell you what, actually. I finally got round to playing some CNC Remastered out in the wild. And it turns out I've not forgotten some of the things I learned in the 90s, man. APC full of engineers? In the back of the base. Killed a guy. Flame tanks? Round the back of the base. Killed a guy. What else did we do? I did a lot of cheese. Oh yeah, a recon bike spam? Killed some guys. Yeah, man. Brotherhood of Nod. I'm having some fun on the ladder with CNC Remastered, I gotta tell you. Why do tank hunters get so little love? Fox125, you're on my wavelength, friend. Let's introduce these two players and then we'll talk about it. So spawning in the north here, going to be going with the defensive doctrine, which is not only a favorite doctrine of mine at the moment. I think it's good in the meta. I think it plays well for Wehrmacht, but it's great on this map because the Stug-E is such a killer on this map. And so are these other abilities, very useful on this map. It's going to be the Wehrmacht forces of Elpern. And spawning in the south here, playing as the Soviet forces, it is going to be Hireling, who I don't actually think we've cast before. But was the top-rated live game on the lobby and is playing against Elpern, so it has to know their stuff. Looking forward to seeing what they're going to bring here. It looks like we've got a choice of guard motor coordination tactics, guard rifle combined arms tactics. This one keeps popping up, and I don't know why people are taking it. And the shock rifle frontline tactics, all of which are quite good on this map. I think it's probably, for me, guard motor or shock rifle are going to be the best on this map, and I think shock rifle I would prefer, because the IS-2 is actually really good on this map. So why do tank hunters get so little love? I wish I could explain that, Elpern. Really, I do. I just wish I could explain it. For me, I was taught the value of tank hunters really early on in Company of Heroes 2 when I noticed that I would be super far ahead as Wehrmacht, and then an SU-85 would arrive for my opponent and I would lose the game. Like, that happened a lot of times. And I actually paid some attention to the SU-85 and I was like, hang on, what are the stats on this unit? How does it keep ripping me to shreds? And then I started playing as Soviets, and then I learned how to micro these tank hunters and stuff like that. And I was just like, you know what? This is the way forward. And for me, it's because tank hunters actually change the dynamic of the game. Like, they force your opponent to have to play so differently, and those differences give you so many advantages. I really think that there are two stages to the game, in a way. there are two stages to your average Company of Heroes 2 game. Let me put it that way. Your normal-ish looking Company of Heroes 2 game. There is before Tank Hunter comes out, and then there is after Tank Hunter comes out, and you have to play those two phases differently. And certainly for Soviets, and to a lesser extent, OKW, I think you should be playing to get a Tank Hunter out. Now, with OKW, you have the option of a Panther, which is kind of an intermediate Tank Hunter, and there are some other things that the other factions can do, but yeah, if your faction has a strong Tank Hunter and you're not using it when there are plenty of targets for it, or when it's a good time to bring it out, I don't know. I just see a lot of players just fall into that mistake, and I don't understand why. But I'm not afraid to talk about it. I'm not afraid to be critical of these decisions, and maybe some top turret level players can shed some light on why people aren't using tank destroyers very much. Anyway, looks like we've got triple Ostrobrunn MG42 here for Elpern, so making good use of the German defensive doctrine. If we crack the tack, we can see that German forces are actually getting pretty good access to the middle of the map, but getting broken right now. Conscript squads pushing forward and grabbing the cutoff, actually. So this has been a really nice reversal in the opening stages here by Hireling. Conscripts are better than Ostrobrunn, and right now there are four squads of conscripts and three squads of Ostrobrunn. The MG42 is actually like fighting on the doorstep of the base, which the MG42 is always the deciding piece in the early game for Wehrmacht, and if it's not out there supporting your Ostrobrunn, then you're going to lose to conscripts. So that's kind of what's happening. Yeah, I mean, you're right, A-Game. Good opponents do know how to deal with Tank Hunters, and for sure, the SU-85 and its analogues are vulnerable to being flanked, especially by fast-moving vehicles. And it can be very frustrating when the units that you've got these Tank Hunter to counter like end up killing it, like your opponent kills your Tank Hunter with a Panzer IV or two or something like that. That's frustrating. But if you watch the replay, you will be able to identify a moment where you made a mistake with that SU-85, or you know, sorry, it sounds like I'm being really critical of you, where the player with the SU-85 made a mistake with that unit. And it's not very intuitive, I will grant you. Sometimes the mistake is slow fleeting, like you didn't move it back at a certain moment, or you rotated it too far, which then meant that it had to rotate to face the threat, and that was enough time for the tank to get on its flank. It's really small decisions, you know. But if you are able to micro the SU-85 perfectly, which is very difficult, it is almost impossible, like, to deal with. It's just that perfect micro is like almost impossible to come by in RTSs, but I mean, you can still get better and better and like attain or aim to achieve that level of skill with the unit. And it's so devastating. And here's the thing, it's actually not super expensive either. Like, I know it's not cheap, but it is okay to lose an SU-85 sometimes. And usually, you know, if you support it well, SU-85s and other tank destroyers, they work really well with another unit to hide behind, like another medium tank or something to hide behind. So, and that actually makes them much more difficult to flank. So yeah. Okay. Oh yeah, Fox125, yeah, okay, cool. I mean, welcome to the game. If you bought it last week, that's sweet. Glad to hear that you're getting value out of the Stug. Pro tip, the spotting scope commanders go really well on the Stug. And yeah, Stugs are really cool. I think Stugs are like underused by Wehrmacht. Like, no other faction has access to a Stug-like unit around the time that Wehrmacht get access to the Stug. And it's such an interesting unit, because it is effective against all targets if you just look after it. And, you know, with veterancy, it becomes such a monster. Anyway, looks like we're going to have a 2-2-2 scout car in this game. Shock troops are out on the field, which means it is going to be the shock rifle frontline tactics, which is kind of the commander I was hoping that we'd see here from the Soviet player. So the table beginning to be set here for an interesting mid-game. We may have the prospect of a KV-8, and later on in the game we have the prospect of an IS-2, so that could be fun to watch. I'm very much looking forward to that. 2-2-2 is going to be out on the field, and that should be a massive help. If you look at this army on the top right, the 2-2-2 here is going to be super useful. Anti-vehicle grenade research has actually not finished for the Soviet player. It's not on the way even. So this 2-2-2 is going to have considerable freedom to wreak havoc upon these Russians. Here it is. And indeed, the shock troops actually represent quite a value-dense target for them as well. Going to use smoke here to just try and stay here. Attack ground going to be used in response. So both these two players duking and jiving, dodging and weaving, and neither player finding any crippling blows, but Elpern definitely on the back foot right now. But that's okay, we can definitely rally on the Ostrobrunn commander, the defensive doctrine here. is a really robust commander, and it is quite hard to stamp him out of the map, especially when you've got like three squads of Ostermen. Panzer Grenadier is going to be mixed into the roster now to add some much needed elite sort of punch. Those STGs actually trading beautifully out of these buildings. The shock troops kind of actually staying a little too long here. 222 scout car is actually going to get up on top of them on the retreat. Uh-oh, this looks bad. Uh-oh. Oh no. Oh no. This looks so bad. If he loses the shock troops, that is a lot of manpower to lose this early. Oh, the RNG is going to favour the Soviet player here. Highland getting a bit lucky there. Elpern identifying a window to try and wipe the shock troops and playing nicely to maximise it, but isn't going to get rewarded in this timeline, and that is unfortunate for the Axis player.
A sector has been cut off.
So it looks like finally Elpern is going to be able to access the midline of the map, do something about the scoreline, which has been slowly ticking away against him. As the next conscript wave comes out of the base, fully reinforced and ready to rock. This 222, as I thought, it's just doing good work out here. Wow, actually, we've still not got anti-tank grenade package. Okay. Gonna rely instead upon the Zis gun, which is just now entering the field. For our anti-tank needs. And that's gonna help control this 222, but you'll be very lucky to get a kill on a 222 with a Zis gun, especially without anti-vehicle grenades to help. So I would like to see anti-vehicle grenades come up when possible here for Hireling. Hireling's fuel income has actually been pretty decent this game as well, actually. I've just realised. Oh, God! Hireling, no! I think we've forgotten about these conscripts. Okay, he gets the fallback. Whew! I'll tell you another thing, actually, about having played Command & Conquer Remastered quite a lot recently. Those death sounds are, like, horrifying, you know? They sound so gribbly in that game. When you lose infantry in that game, you feel it in your bones. You know, really reminds you that war is hell. They're just so disgusting, the death noises. Anyway, sorry, I keep getting distracted by thinking about Command & Conquer Remastered. So okay, Pat Gun comes out at the right time here for Elpern. So that is the good old Pat Gun to not die to T-70. This is kind of the thing that we saw missing from Skeletron earlier. Even this Pat Gun, perhaps a little late, coming out like after 9 minutes. But that's okay, the Soviet player wasn't going for a fast T-70. And it looks like Hireling is likely to retake the doorstep of their base. Actually, we've got telemines in some lovely positions, actually. Elpern able to creep forward and get telemines here is really nice. No metal detector for the Soviet player. So if and when we see a tank, those telemines are in prime position. Oh, the 222! Yeah, I was going to say the 222 splashes the telemines, and that will blow them up. Killing just two Soviet engineers. So a little bit of undisciplined fire there. As the 222 auto-attacks probably those engineers. And that's really annoying, gonna blow up the telemines. These things happen. There's a timeline where that gets a squad wipe and we all think that Elpern's a genius, but we're not watching that game. Seeing all these roads not being negative cover is bothering you. Oh yeah, they're not negative cover. Huh, did they change that? Or is that just a Langriskaya thing? I've never actually thought about it. That's really interesting. Anyway, STG Toten Panzergren's going to try and overrun here. Whoa, overstaying their welcome, bro. Really? What the? He gets the break on all these units. Jesus, somebody award this man the Iron Cross. He just scared off a lot of Russians by himself. That was epic. Nice little moment there for those Panzergrens, but he's going to have to GTFO now. Fallback, reinforce, keep that squad alive. So we're on three squads of Ostermen, two squads of Panzergrenadiers. I'd love to see another MG42 or possibly a mortar for the German player. Another MG42 and possibly a mortar, I should say. Let's just quickly check the tech here for Elpern. Battle phase 2 not started yet, but I imagine that will be on the queue as soon as we have the manpower for it, because the Stug E is really good. Do you actually need the support armor core, or do you just need battle phase? You just need battle phase 2. Man, the Stug E is so good. Wow, you don't even need to build the support armor core. I was pretty sure that was the case, but I wanted to check before I said it. Stug E is sick, man. I'm telling you, 75 fuel, 260 manpower. And that unit almost always goes on to pay dividends. Like, it's a rare game where the Stug E actually looked bad. The red... Okay, A-game giving us some enlightenment about the red cover system in the map editor being really annoying to work with. Okay. Some of the text just can be used for both roads and normal time. Oh, I'm pretty sure it is intentional on Langriskaya. Probably because if having negative cover around the central VP would have just been too horrendous, especially for the south spawning player. So I think on Langriskaya it's intentional. To be honest, they probably just found that Langriskaya is like horrendous enough of a map to try and keep your units alive on without having a crisscrossing web of negative cover running all over it as well. I imagine that's what the case was. All right.
Our lines of supply are disrupted.
So a pretty even game so far. Elpen just taking the upper hand over this last phase of play, though. It takes a small but significant lead in the scoreline. So that might be useful as this game goes on. Soviet forces make a bit of a land grab, though. And that's going to try and redress that. Soviet composition in a decent place. I'd love to see another Maxim gun and or another Zis gun as the game develops. But for now, this is a fine place to be for, what are we on now? 13 and a half minutes. Oh my god. Shock troops are in a really weird place in the meta at the moment because, bear in mind, they are one of the most expensive infantry squads in the game at 360 manpower. That is more expensive than Obersoldaten. And I know that they're a six-man squad. I know they have PPSHs. I know they have decent grenades and body armor. But I just don't actually, even when they have veterancy, I feel like I never really see them achieve very much. They're a good pushing infantry squad, I grant you, but I'm not sure that they justify their absolutely premium cost. They just seem, I don't know, like they're just lacking something. There's no spice on that unit. They're very easy to deal with, usually. When I see my opponent get shocks, I'm just like, whew! Whereas when I see my opponent get guards, I'm like, okay, that could be a problem. And I feel like shocks just need a bit of help. I know through various phases of Company of Heroes 2, though, shocks have been like problematically OP. And so they've been balanced to a state where they work within the game at the moment, but it just feels like they're not quite delivering often enough. And more like they often just seem like a liability because they're so value dense, they feed so much veterancy, they're expensive to reinforce. Your opponent will always love to shoot at them, and I don't really feel like you're getting enough back for that. Anyway, 222 gonna come in here. The Zis gun has it acquired, and there's gonna be another shot. Is he gonna be able to get the kill on the 222? Oh wow, he's actually behind the line of sight blocker. I guess it is. No attack ground round coming through, and the 222 sneaks away on a pixel of health. Shock troops, though, eager to prove me wrong, gonna take a dive here. They kill two pounds of grenadiers, and that's it, and then have to fall back. I guess they were advancing into a flamethrower, which is pretty rough. Vet 3 seems pretty big for shock troops. Yeah, well, it's been a while since I've refreshed my knowledge of the veterancy on shock troops, so in just a second I'll have a little look, and we'll see what the deal is. Here we go. So Vet 1 gives you reduces the cost of smoke grenades and the cooldown. Okay, interesting. Vet 2, survivability increase and DPS increase. And Vet 3, DPS increase.
Enemy forces capturing supply set.
Yeah. I don't know. They just seem outclassed by Storm Pioneers and things for DPS. I don't know. Maybe I'm wrong. Maybe I need to actually pay closer attention. Maybe they're better than I think. It's a 40% accuracy increase. Okay, well, no doubt that is significant. Well, these shock troops do seem poised to reach 3 stars of veterancy, so when they do achieve that, let's pay attention to them and see exactly how dangerous they are for the Axis infantry. How are PPSHs these days, anyway? I mean, obviously you want to get them as close as possible to your opponent, but are they really that dangerous? I don't know. Oh no, he lost the MG42? Oh, I didn't see that. God damn, so the Axis player is actually going to donate an MG into this Soviet roster here. That is lovely for Hireling. We will gladly accept such donations. Zis gun, though, going to use a barrage in a super risky play. He uses the point-blank barrage, but there's a lot of Struppens here. Luckily, support arrives in the nick of time. Shock Troop's going to push back these Struppens. Looking for that third star of veterancy. They're very close onto it now. Yeah. Infantry veterancy being... there are some survivability upgrades at 3 stars of veterancy A-game, but I take your point. It does seem to prioritise DPS at the higher veterancies. Anyway, okay, 3 stars of veterancy is done, and those shock troops are taking some names against these pioneers. There we go. They're going to secure mid-VP. Let's keep an eye on them as this game goes on, because I feel like I'm super out of touch. Personally, as well, I've never favoured shocks. I'm always a guards Soviet player when it comes down to it. So I don't really have the most experience using them either. The Axis army here going to get reinforced and ready to head back on out. And a decent score lead still for Alpern, but the triple cap now going to be established by the Soviet player. So it's on Alpern now to re-secure the midline of the map. And I'd love to see a Stug E coming out. The ability is lit, but the fact that he's not buying one and hasn't bought one so far might demonstrate, yup, we're going to battle phase three. What's he doing? I'm excited. Could this be a quick Brumbar? Dun, dun, dun. That would be really cool. I would love a quick Brumbar. Let's do it. Let's do it. Do it.
Our opponents are seizing a sector.
Yeah, that's also a really good point, actually, Datton. Yeah, the received accuracy, which is the usual survivability buff, doesn't really play in against the cannons and things on vehicles. And it doesn't really help you against mortars or, like, quite a lot of the deadly stuff that's being hurled around at your infantry in this game. So, yeah, it's a good point, Dan. Fair point. Alright, going up to double this gun right now is Heiling, and that does make sense. We've seen no real Axis fuel units. I mean, other than this 222, but that hardly counts. So, you know that Alpern is up to something. We're 18 minutes in this game. No Panzer IV, no Oswin, no Stug. So, what's he doing? Might need to get a second Zis gun. I like that. That actually kind of does make some sense. And it's also not like the Axis player hasn't had a fuel point connected this whole time. So, yep. Something is up over there. And Schwerpanzer HQ is done. Or Heavy Panzer Corps, as it might be called for the Wehrmacht. So remember, as I like to keep pointing out, because it's such a cool change, this building, once built, does mean that Axis units cost 25% less manpower to reinforce, and they capture points 25% faster. Now, on a super grindy map like Langriskaya, if you can throw that building down at like the 18 and a half, 19 minute mark, it's going to start paying for itself earlier and earlier. So that's a really good thing to have thrown down and gotten established at this early point in the game. So I like that. That's really sick. And we're going to see, I mean, it has to be Brumbar, right? This is such a good map for a Brumbar. Or is he going to rush Panther? No, we're not rushing Panther. He can afford the Brumbar, right? Yeah, we can afford the Brumbar. What is he saving this fuel for? I have to know. All right, Alpern, though, microing like a champ, takes the midline of the map. Lovely fights being taken out there. Brumbar! Yes! All right, excitement. This is going to be a Brumbar game. Well, the shock troops have a smoke grenade of their own, but I take your point. I mean, what, are you suggesting that they get a mortar to work with, and then that can put down some more smoke to enable the shocks to be good? I could see that. The KV-1 also works well with shocks, because it's something big for them to hide behind, and doesn't it also have the mobile smoke system on it? So that would be nice to check. Okay, yeah, Dan, yeah, I like the suggestion of comboing shock troops with mortar. I think that's really smart. LMG-42 is popping up on these Ostrepun, enabling them to take some names. These shock troops not really able to close into productive range here. And the Brumbar is about to arrive. Now, you know who else has been saving their fuel? The Soviet player. Heiling has not invested in a T-70, and we've not had any T-34s, so it's going to be a KV-8. Are you kidding me? I thought for sure he was saving for the IS-2. What the hell? We were nearly at the IS-2. 230 fuel. 230 fuel. So he was like 85 fuel. So it was like he needed to save like 30 more fuel and we could have had the IS-2. I don't think this KV-8 is going to be very good. Here comes the Brumbar. Brumbar game. Brumbar game. God damn, I don't know what it is about heavy assault gun style units and things that explode in a really big way, but I really like them. So, hooray, Brumbar is out. Let's see what happens. Hey, conscripts! Flump! Takes off like 75% of their health, kills two of them. Nice opening shell. How much veterancy does that look like on a Brumbar? Yeah, that's reasonable. That's a reasonable wedge of, like, you know, you could see with like 6 or 7 shells like that, he could easily get a level of veterancy. That's pretty dope. Panzerwerfer for the follow-up. Oh my god, Alpern. I'm becoming a fan. This is devastating stuff. Soviet player with a KV-8. Is this really the answer? I don't know. Oh god, the Brumbar's just doing mean things. Look at the veterancy stack up on this thing. It actually vets up quite quick, doesn't it? If it's actually scoring hits, it vets up pretty quick. Which is weird for a quite an expensive anti-infantry tool. They usually vet up a little slower, so Cool. Brumbar going to be doing Brumbar things here. Triple cap is established by the Axis player. Hey, Shock Troops, how about that? Look at the veterancy! That was so much value it just scored. So much value. Good God. Oh, God. These Shock Troops are not having a good time. The Brumbar is... Whoa! Okay, I thought he was going to smash those Panzer Grenadiers there. A scary moment for those Panzer Grenadiers. Yikes. But, yeah, the Brumbar going to lumber back for now. This KV-8, what has it actually done? It's burned one dude and not scored a lot of veterancy. So, I don't know. I mean, the Brumbar is unlikely to take out the KV-8. Okay, we've got Panzerwerfer as well now. Oh my god, Elpern is positioned very well in this game, I feel like. How do you really deal with this? Your Zisk guns now are basically worthless. Because how are they ever going to bring down a Brumbar when there's a Panzerwerfer to help it? Wow, the sound glitch. That explosion did not play a sound. Interesting. So finally, the KV-8 does find some value. They're going to burninate some Panzer Grenadiers. That's good to do. What is hitting this thing in the rear armor? What was that? I missed that. It was a pack gun round. Cool. Nice shot. So the KV-8 is going to have to repair. There are no engineers. There are no engineers. Oh. That's awkward. I think Hirelings just realized that as well, so they're going to replace them. Conscript's trying to get something done, but look at this dug-in position. Look at the Brumbar. And I'm going to be honest, actually. You know how earlier on in the game we were talking about how SU-85s like change the dynamic of the game, and they make it play in a Panzerwerfer barrage, and they make the game play in a different way after the SU-85 is out. Your opponent has to play the game differently. I actually feel like the Brumbar is also a dynamic changer of the game. It forces your opponent to play the game in a very different way, which brings a lot of advantages to the Axis player. So it's like there's a pre-Brumbar stage of the game where the game works a certain way, and then a post-Brumbar age where things are just very different. And Elpern using a really stable build here to get into Brumbar relatively rapidly. I mean, what was this? It was like a 19-minute support armor core with the Brumbar coming down really soon after. So this was like a 21 and a half, 22-minute Brumbar, something like that, I feel like. Maybe a bit earlier. I can't quite remember. Didn't make a mental note of the timestamp on this Brumbar. But, oh God, I mean, look at what it does. Oishk. This is so nasty. And the Soviet player really cannot reach out and touch that Brumbar in any threatening way. We can score stray Zisk gun hits on it, but the Brumbar actually just has a huge HP pool. And with the Panzerwerfer, even taking Zisk gun shots onto the Brumbar is a little bit scary. Jesus, actually, yeah, we've got three weapon teams stacked up here. That's a bit scary when we know where our opponent has Panzerwerfer. So, oh god, Panzer Grenadier is going to be supporting this Brumbar. Arrgh! That's so close to being a squad wipe, which the Soviet player cannot sustain. We cannot be sustaining squad wipes right now. Panzer Grenadiers, remember, they get the combined arms buff, so they actually work quite well with the Brumbar as well. I mean, this is looking rough for the Soviet player. I'll be honest, I thought he was saving for the IS-2, and that is an okay answer to the Brumbar. That can stand up to the Brumbar and make it so that the Brumbar can't just be taking whatever shots it wants on the map. Panzerwerfer, where's that going? Oh, it's going onto the Maxim. Scoring some okay damage, but nothing game-changing. But the KV-8, and the thing is, Hirelings let the KV-8 finish after they had seen the Brumbar. I'm pretty sure I made a mental note of that fact, and that is a weird thing to do. And now we're stuck in a situation where we've got all of our fuel in a KV-8, we don't have enough for an IS-2, we've got great infantry, but how do we use it? Because our opponent has a Brumbar and we can't do anything about the Brumbar and a Panzerwerfer. And, you know, because of that, look at the scoreline, you know, 134. Hirelings is being choked out now. This Brumbar is stamping on Hirelings, and it feels like there's not much to do there. What's up, AkiHQ? Good to see you in chat there, friend. What did you miss? You missed a game with Skeletron where he used German infantry, and it just looked like German infantry always does when I cast it. He, like, died in 20, 25 minutes because he didn't have pack guns. And, yep, that was bad. And now we're in the second game, and Elpern has rushed to Brumbar. And not even rushed that hard, not in a dangerous way. Just gone for rapid, safe, efficient, sturdy Brumbar. It was a safe build. And now the Brumbar is dominating. And the Soviet player has awkwardly put all their fuel into a KV-8, which hasn't really done anything yet. So that's a problem. And look, these conscripts just cannot fight here. There's a Brumbar. And I think a really smart thing that I see a lot of players do, but not in this case with the Brumbar, is you can set it to just prioritize vehicles, and then you can manually click on the infantry squads you want it to fire at. So We're not seeing Elpern do that, but it's just a tip for Vermac players who might be watching. That's a useful thing you can do. Okay, finally the KV-8 manages to bust through with no regard for the Brumbar. Oh no, though, it gets donked by a Panzerfaust. There is a pack gun in the hood. It's on low health now. And it may have overextended here, creating a fiery wasteland through the middle of the map. I do like what the KV-8 does. Like, it looks visually awesome, doesn't it? We're going to burn off a Ziss gun here. Nice, nice, nice. German infantry pushing hard. Whoops, as my mouse has another malfunction. Elpern on top of the infantry micro, though. Going to pull his Panzergrenadiers out of the fire. And was that a Panzerwerfer barrage that hit his Panzergrenadiers? That's a touch awkward. But he does get the other Ziss gun, so... Uh-oh, Panzergrenadiers need to fall back, and they will. Okay, so he gets the other Ziss gun. That's nice. The KV-8 is still lumbering away, trying to find somewhere it can repair in peace. This pack gun is stalking it down, though. Has it solidly in arc here. Something is happening. His sector artillery is coming down as well. So Elpern turning up the heat here, putting so much pressure onto Hireling. This sector artillery is disproportionately great on this map as well, because if I crack the tack briefly, you can see, look at the size of this middle sector. That is a shield behind which the Wehrmacht units can stabilize and cement their position. So that's really nice. The Brumbar now has 2 stars of veterancy. The armored skirts are up on that bad boy. Does that also get it mobility? No, rate of fire increase. Jesus. So that's going to start hitting, like, a Brumbar, basically, again. that's really nasty. Yeah, he could get an SU-85. That would really help, actually. But there's already going to be a Panther on the queue here. I think we... Oh, God. I mean, this is a rough game. I think if you see your opponent has a Brumbar, right, you cannot let the KV-8 finish. You have to get an SU-85 because that turns the Brumbar into kind of a paperweight. It's like if the Brumbar wants to come into range to take some shots, it's going to be put down to like 1/3 of its health by an SU-85, maybe worse. So like, yeah, SU-85s really control Brumbars. That is the appropriate counter. And that is not what we saw in this game. So anyway, the KV-8 has escaped. It's going to try and repair. That was the Brumbar. I thought that was the tail end of sector artillery still. But I mean, there's a triple cap here. There's no way for the Soviet player to get out here. And Hireling is going to die with 230 odd fuel in his pocket. That is awkward. You cannot take that fuel with you, my friend. It stays in this game. It will not help you next game. So, that's really nice. Oh, God. 6 stars worth of Panzergrenadier veterancy comes punching through like a German shiv and just takes out the heart of the Allied infantry. The Brumbar standing undaunted in mid. The Panzerwerfer actually not really doing a lot, but the Panzerwerfer is a high variance unit, and there's probably a timeline where it like wins the game somewhere. Like, it all just depends on the barrages you take and the spread on those rockets. It's a gamble, and it didn't really pay off this game, but that's okay. It was taken as a gamble. It was icing on the cake. We didn't need it, but it would have been nice for it to do something. And look, there was a Panther coming out right when this game finished. I mean, Elpern navigating this game in what appears to be some of the most proficient and professional Wehrmacht tactics I've ever seen. I mean, that was just domination, really. There was some back and forth in the early stages of the game, but I never ever felt worried for Elpern. There was actually one moment where he gave an MG42 to the Soviets. I will say, actually, that was concerning, but didn't let him get him down. So yeah, wow, nasty stuff. That is a great Axis commander, fair point. And yeah, it was cleanly executed. I like it. You guys are all right in the chat. You're all correct. Christ. I think Wehrmacht players should be leaning into Stugs and Brumbars more. They seem great. Not both, one or the other, depending on what the game's doing. But like, definitely the Brumbar. If you can reach Brumbar, that is so... That makes you quite hard to kill as a Wehrmacht player. The Brumbar is a bulwark against the Allies. So anyway, let's head on to the live game lobby and see if we can find another. We've got Angry Dutchman versus... Yeah, we're probably going to cast that one. Yeah, we're casting that one. Sweet. All right, a Vilshanka game here. Again, Wehrmacht versus Soviets. Yeah, KOTU has some... They chose the vehicles really well in KOTU, didn't they, A-game? The only one for me that was a little bit eh was the Ostwind, but even that is great fun to watch. I just prefer the Verbalwind for various reasons, just because it's more iconic, more of them were made, so it's kind of more historically accurate, and it has that, the flak veerling just has such a ridiculous sound, like that rolling quad-barreled nonsense is just like cool. But I you know, it's nice to see the Ostwind. You don't actually tend to see it out and about very often. Wow, this game's actually good to go immediately, but I'm not, so just bear with me 1 second. I'm quickly gonna just take a quick 5 minute break here. I'll be back at 5 past. I just need to like check my email, stretch my legs, and just have a quick break. But I'll be right back with you guys. I'll catch you in 5 minutes. Thank you very much, everyone, for tuning in. Keep it locked, and I'll be right back. Greetings and a very warm welcome back. The Sun is Hiding and the Magpie is casting, taking us into the next game right now. Alrighty. Let's have a looky here. So the map is going to be Vilshanka, which is not one we get to cast very often, to be honest. Oh wow, we've got some really interesting commander picks just coming down instantly for these two players. Spawning in the west as the Vermac pieces, it is Zavers the Angry Dutchman, who has given us some brilliant games on the channel recently. And spawning in the east, the Red Army, indeed, accurately spawning as red in the east. It's going to be Kanji. Kanji's going for the Armored Assault Doctrine. Armored Assault Tactics, if you will. So another IS-2 commander going to be used here. But I think... it's actually really hard for me to say which is my favourite IS-2 commander. I think this is the better late-game IS-2 commander for sure. Because you get the vehicle repairs, and most crucially, you get the Sturmovik attack, which combined with the IS-2 is usually enough to break whatever your Axis opponent is up to. So that's a nice combination that you just don't get on any other commander. Angry Dutchman going for Jaeger Infantry Doctrine. Not fully sure that I actually understand the choice here. I like Jaeger Infantry Doctrine. I suppose it has been changed, so it has some interesting stuff now. I'm just not really sure, like, why is this what Vermac players want? I get that in a vacuum, these are not useless abilities. They are not useless. But, like, why do we want these things? So we get the camo, we get the ambush training, which can be useful. We get the G43 upgrade, but it's not the, It's not the veteran squad leader upgrade. It's two G43s, so it's more DPS-y, I suppose, but it doesn't fix the fragility of Grenadiers at all. Oh, wow, it's a techless opening. Huh. Okay, then. Well, I guess I'm about to live and learn, because I have no idea what the Angry Dutchman is up to here. So it's going to be an MG42 Pioneer opener, which is fine. Wow, no Grenadiers. Alright. We're going to see what happens, I suppose. But then, yeah, we get the Jaeger Command Squad later on, which they're fine as well. The Light Artillery Barrage, that's reasonable. That's fine. And then the Stuka Close Air Support. Having two munition dumps is a touch awkward, perhaps. But Stuka Close Air Support is a very good one to have. So that's cool. Ambush training on the MG42 with incendiary ammo can kill a squad in seconds. Good point. Good point, Aki HQ. Obviously, a lot has to go right for you to get that that engagement. But yeah, I take your point. How much is the... So it would be 20... Only 20 munitions for the ambush camouflage. That's actually a lot cheaper than I remember it being. So, okay. Yeah, I'm open to being impressed here. Can Pioneers take it? No. Okay. That would have been nice. That would have been so... If you could have ambush flamethrowers, that would be hilarious. All right, so it's going to be double MG42, double Pioneer, Panzer Grenadiers. Okay, and this is a build that you can do with any commander, of course, because, I mean, we're not seeing any commander-specific stuff. This is just things that Vermac get for having no tech, which is nice. Vermac actually have a really good techless toolkit. Soviet mines there are going to blast a couple of these Pioneers down, but the MG42 is thundering away in the hood, and that will force back these Soviet forces. And, yeah, Angry Dutchman looking just fine out here. I mean, Angry Dutchman, as I said at the start, one of the best players for giving us good games recently on the channel. And I am cautiously optimistic that they do know what they're doing. So this looks left field and weird. This looks a bit bizarre, this build. But I'm really hoping, fingers crossed, that he's not going to die to, like, an 8-minute T-70 or something. Just, like, something super normal that Soviets do a lot of the time. Just let's not die to that. And then I'll be happy. Yeah, 45% accuracy buff for the ambush. Okay, it's really good to have the numbers there. Thanks, Aki HQ. Yeah, that is actually a massive DPS increase, isn't it? Yeah. Okay, fair enough. And it does stack with the vet bonuses, I believe it does, yeah. Should do. Let's have a look at the bulletins here for these commanders while they're kind of getting their initial scuffles underway. Looks like we've got the mines cost less, we've got the Panzerfaust range, and we've got the Panzer Grenadiers. 3% increased accuracy, so that's some decent DPS buff for that unit. Because of their high rate of fire, it's probably going to give you a disproportionately decent bonus as well. So this is definitely a build that Angry Dutchman was angling for, because we're not seeing any, there are no Grenadier DPS buffs here. There is a Panzer Grenadier DPS buff. So Angry Dutchman is out here for playing weird stuff with Vermax. And that's cool. Looks like it's all conscript DPS here for Kanji. So that's pretty standard. Yeah, nothing to write home about there. Pretty boring stuff. Boring but good. Like the Mechanized Company comes down at 5 minutes, so unlike Skeletron, who we saw earlier, who was doing some kind of weird techless stuff and is often seen doing that, we're going to have the Like the Mechanized Company. I grant you that Skeletron was trying to skip this rather than skipping Infantry Company, but I think that is so dangerous. And we saw it happen again, where Skeletron just kind of got beaten down by a light tank. And like, you really do have to build Like the Mechanized Company. I'm becoming convinced that you do just need to build it. The units that you get from it are very useful, and I don't know, Vermacht are balanced around having access to the pack gun. If you decide not to use the pack gun, you're going to have a hard time. I'm not saying it's impossible, but it's very difficult. It's very dangerous. Yes, let's see if the Soviet player remembers to listen to the radio intercepts and counters the scout car. Yep, anti-vehicle grenade coming down pretty much as soon as we heard that the scout car was arriving, so it appears that Kanji was paying attention to those radio intercepts, yes. I imagine we will see a Zis gun, perhaps, or we might just proceed straight to T-70, but that is still a... Actually, we could have T-70 by now if we put the tech down, or like it would be on the queue sort of thing, so... where is he? Yep, here we go, Tankerbee Battalion coming down. Actually, okay, it seems that I actually didn't add that up correctly. We still need 20 more fuel, but, like, the fuel income is actually amazing for Kanji right now. Did we connect double fuel there for a second? We did. Did we? I don't know. But anyway, plus 29 fuel income is great. And plus 58 munitions. Good God, Kanji off to a great start here. More mines finding Panzer Grenadiers as well. So Angry Dutchman having a pretty troubled opening engagement, or opening stage to this game, I guess is what I'm trying to say. And for four squads of conscripts and one squad of engineers, the Soviet player has sure been able to find a lot of value. This is really good from Kanji. Especially up against double MG42 as well. How's he doing this? This is great stuff. I guess it helps that Vilshankar is a much wider map, so that the advantage of those two MG42s is a little more difficult to bring to bear. T-70 on the queue, that makes a lot of sense. No, cancels, gonna go for a Zis gun. Changes his mind. All right, I'm open to seeing what we're gonna use this fuel for then. Nope, changes his mind again. Goes back to the T-70. All right. This does seem like a great window for a T-70, right? Because the 222 is being problems. The map is quite large, so the speed of the T-70 is going to be useful for checking the flanks and things. I feel like this is a good spot for a T-70. I know there's a pack gun out already, but again, Vilshankar, one of the sort of broader maps around the middle, so this pack gun cannot be in every fight, and it's going to be relatively easy for that T-70 to avoid its arc. Yeah, dude, AKHQ, I would love to see an SU-76, but we don't normally see it. Wow, that is really interesting, A-Game. You enabled radio intercepts for all factions in a mod. That would make games closer. That definitely would make games closer. I feel like then you should also give players a radio silence option where, like, they can spend 50 munitions to silence the radio for the next 30 seconds or something. That would be fun. I don't know. 50 munitions was just a number off the top of my head as well. That might be way out. Anyway, T-70 here gets found by the pack gun. Jaeger Command Squad going to be trying to get some work done, but the conscripts come in just in the nick of time to deny that. The MG42s are not covering this middle area. One of them's up here in the north. The other one is just getting into position to cover this area. So Soviet forces finding work out here. The G43 upgrades finishing on Panzer Grenadiers, making them quite the DPS-y sort of powerhouse. In good cover, and they're going to force those conscripts away. Maxim gun going to be the next choice here for Kanji, and I love that. I think that is definitely the thing we need now to help defend the middle of the map and help curtail this Axis infantry, which is becoming a bit spicy, to be honest. Lots of G43s popping up. Still no infantry company, so we're just going to be playing it without the infantry company. And to be honest, I reckon that Panzer Grenadiers, MG42s, and Pioneers are all so good that together with the Jaeger Command Squad, we can totally play without Grenadiers, so that's cool. Yeah, I really like what I'm seeing here. Angry Dutchman is like pioneering techless Burmax in ways that are really interesting. Oh, okay. Thanks, A-Game. Nice. I'm glad I could have chipped in. And to balance the ability, if it's becoming too strong, you can make it so that when someone presses the radio silence thing, that gets announced. So it says like, our opponents of radio nets have gone dark. And then like, you know that they are trying to hide something, maybe, but it could also be a bluff because you could use it when you're not having a unit coming out, so you can mess with your opponent a bit. I don't know. There's like a whole little mini game there that's good, that could be quite fun to explore.
Enemy forces are securing our territory.
Yeah. Always interesting to have you in the chat there, A-Game, because you actually do RTS game design as well as play, so that's really cool. So it looks like Kanji is kind of closing the noose, pushing forwards, or trying. Getting still, I'm surprised by how much work these conscripts are being able to do against double MG42 with great support. Double metal detector here for Angry Dutchman. Doesn't want to fall foul of any more of those annoying Soviet mines that we've already seen blow up a couple of Axis squads. So. Did he just... Oh no, it wasn't a squad wipe. Okay, sorry. Thought for a second he got a squad wipe on those conscripts, but it wasn't. That's okay. Yeah, more mines coming down here. Soviet player doing Soviet player things, but there's... With two metal detectors, you have to think it's very unlikely that these mines are actually going to be profitable now. T-70 going to enter the fight, and it looks like both players are winding up for a pretty decent-sized conflict here in south. Lots of units pouring in from both sides. Where's the Maxim gun for the Soviet? Okay, so that is in mid right now, overwatching mid VP. That's actually quite nice. That is not shooting right now, but it is securing the flank of this Soviet position, so that's nice to have. 222 going to come forward. The Pat gun actually finds the T-70 for a nice hit there, and another, so the T-70 now has to be very careful. Going to fall back and try and hook up with some of these two squads of Soviet engineers. I like the way that both of these players have gone up to two squads of engineers real fast, actually. That's cool. And these conscripts are just going to stay here and try and trade out and be as annoying as possible. Double pack gun definitely revealed by Angry Dutchman, so Kanji didn't know about that, and then they will now. And that's a little bit scary for a T-70. Now, well, obviously, two shot volley the T-70 down, which is quite a fast time to kill. Conscript's going to GTFO. Axis forces trying to push in north, but there are conscripts harrying them from a structure up here as well. And conscript's going to take mid here. The Maxim gun opting to reposition at possibly an inopportune moment. There are Panzer Grenadiers there. Ooh, they're going to set up as well, kind of on some mines, so they've got to be careful about that. If the 222 comes in and strafes them, it may hit those mines. They're going to start laying into these Panzer Grenadiers. Let's just quickly check the tech for the Axis player. Battle phase 2 about to finish, so we'll soon see if it's going to be support armor core or if we're going to go ahead and go towards Brumbar, as we saw from the last game in Elpern, using the rapid Brumbar, which I think more Vermac players should be doing. It seems good. Check the tech here for the Soviet player. Mechanized armor campania has just finished, and we've got 90 fuel in the bank right now. So we'll see if Kanji wants to take a choice from that building, or if we're just going to see a hard save for IS-2. Probably going to see something before IS-2. Conscript's going to oorah in here, try and capitalize on those mines, which still finding hits here, and the anti-vehicle grenade will be enough to get the kill on the Axis scout car. That's nicely done. The 222 is such a good unit these days. Good players can keep that thing alive forever, and it's like actually just amazing. For the price, it does such a good job of securing your flanks and picking off or policing infantry squads that are trying to get work done. Like, it's the 222 is a fantastic unit. Knocking that one out there at this relatively early stage is nice. Soviet forces continuing to harass fuel. This is material damage, man. The Allied player has had such a resource advantage this whole game as well, which is, like, really nice. Katusha. Ooh, interesting. That would be an interesting plan. I actually don't particularly think that this is a great spot for a Katusha right now. It's an interesting choice, to be honest, and it would probably catch your Axis opponent off guard, but the thing about the Katusha is it only provides value every 100 seconds or so when it launches that barrage in, and the Axis player actually doesn't really have enough units where I feel like it's time to be denying victory points or going for random shots into Fog of War. I mean, there are two pack guns out there, that's true, and two MG42s, so there are some good targets. But even if you break the two pack guns, we actually don't have very much armored. I mean, we've only got a T-70, so even if you get both of the pack guns, they're not actually being that much of a problem for the Soviet player. Oh, mortar. Oh, I like the mortar. I like the mortar a lot. So the mortar actually counters these weapon teams that the Axis player has and can put down smoke. So I think this is a great timing to get a mortar. Mortars always feel like a thing in Company of Heroes that are like really good if you can find the time to afford them. But it's like you can never find that 240 manpower to just quickly get a mortar squad where it's not going to slow everything else down or when you're not gasping for core infantry. But mortars just make everything work better. They just, the ability to have smoke, counter weapon teams, and just sometimes enemy units coming out of Fog of War will just have damage on them from the mortar having hit them, and that can swing fights sometimes. Like, it just can swing fights. And they can be very frustrating to play against, and, you know, mental is big. The mental game in Company of Heroes 2, in any game, but especially in Company of Heroes 2, is big, and it can be demoralizing. You can break your opponent's mental with mortar hits. Like, if a stray mortar hit wipes out a squad, which can happen to Vermax so easily, that feels demoralizing. That makes you just go like, oh god, it's so frustrating. You know, you don't want to keep playing the game if you keep getting wiped out by random mortar shells. It's horrendous. The worst feeling in the world is when the first mortar shell of the game kills your German sniper. I've had that happen to me so many times. You're just like, oh, my opponent has a mortar. I know this because my sniper is dead. And like, that's on me for not saving the sniper. I get that, but it's still like, Jesus, it's like so unlucky. Yeah, mortar works too. Hey, look at us, up to 20 viewers. Yeah, feeling it, that's sick. Thank you very much everybody for tuning in. That's awesome. Welcome to Friday Midday Magpie. Everything's gone really well today. We've cast a game with a broom bar in it. I'm happy. Everything else is just gravy at this point. It's going to be a Panzer IV here from Angry Dutchman. So actually, yeah, I didn't check in, but yeah, the Sport Armor Core is there. Panzer IV will be the choice from that one. And that kind of makes sense. Angry Dutchman actually has had the worst end of the resource differential this whole time. So gonna put the money into a unit which is immediately useful and can scale well, and works well independently of other fuel unit choices. So I like this Panzer IV here. The T-70 there, able to dart in and find the pack gun. That's really nice. There are conscripts in the hood, but the MG42 has them on lock. Oh, they need to get out here. So they won't be able to actually destroy or take out that pack gun. But it's still inconveniencing and annoying for the Axis player to have the veterancy taken off it and have to recrew it. So a nice pickup there for that T-70. And, I mean, Kanji is still stacking fuel, so this kind of looks like the straight to IS-2 route. So if we can get the IS-2 first and then a Katusha, that's fine. Depending on how the game goes, if we start... Oh! Well, Angry Dutchman has disconnected. That's an anti-climax. I guess these things happen. I can only presume that his internet died, because this game was obviously very much alive. Angry Dutchman, without a doubt, behind, having a rough-ish game, but it wasn't unbelievably rough. So there we go. That will be the anticlimactic end to that game. Hazards of casting game on the live game lobby. Thank you very much for your patience and understanding. These things do happen. They are beyond my control. Wow, kind of a shame there. That one was shaping up to be an interesting one, wasn't it? But there we go. Datton, no, the SU-76 barrages used to be free. They now cost something like 25 munitions, as I recall. Apparently they were just too good when they were free. Honestly, well, I don't know. I kind of think they should still be free, because nobody actually uses the SU-76 anymore. Hey, we've got a mirror match. It's Panzer Grenadier and Griefen versus Panzer Grenadier and Griefen. Well, that one sounds too good to miss, doesn't it? Let's just see if we can get any information about which one of these may or may not be the real one. Okay, so the first Panzer Grenadier and Griefen is actually PFC. All right. So there we go. This is going to be a nightmare to cast. Ooh, Datton, I didn't think about that. Aki HQ, maybe we'll see some Magpie play. Ah, you really want to see me play, don't you? Ah, that's fair enough, I can understand. Maybe next week? Possibly next week. I've been having a bit of trouble with the RSI in my hands this week, probably because I've been playing Command & Conquer Remastered. So I would like to play some Company of Heroes. What I would like to do is play some 2v2 to get warmed up, because 2v2 is like a nice way of getting warmed up. And I haven't really played like actual competitive PvP Company of Heroes for a while, so I would need to warm up and like blast the dust off and the rust off. So, hang on a second. Pardon me. Sorry about that. So yeah, I'll play some 2v2 next week. If anybody fancies joining me for some 2v2, that would be sick. I'll need a playing partner, of course. Maybe I'll get in touch with Luciano. We used to play, and I've got a few other mates as well who I could try. Or that would be fun. This is going to be a nightmare to cast. Just call them Wehrmacht and USF. That is a sensible solution. Well done. That's a good one. Actually, I do remember casting a mirror game before where I just decided to call the two players their exact identical screen names just for the sheer fun and confusion of it. And it was both very fun and very confusing. Can confirm. Alrighty, 15 seconds and then we can get on into this. Looks like Panzergrenadier and Griffin going to be running with Austrian Doctrine, Jaeger Infantry Doctrine, and German Infantry Doctrine. Well, I actually only like one of these, so I hope he goes ahead and picks the Austrian Doctrine. Panzergrenadier and Griffin, on the other hand, going to be running with Infantry Company, Rifle Company, and Recon Support Company. So those are the three available there. And yay, it is going to be Austrian Doctrine for Panzergrenadier and Griffin, who I'm just going to call Wehrmacht moving forwards. Spawning in the north, playing as the Austrian Wehrmacht. It will be Wehrmacht, or Panzergrenadier and Griffin. Spawning in the south, playing as the USF forces, who I'm just going to call USF, I guess. It is PFC, using the screen name First Panzergrenadier and Griffin. So there we have it, our two players for this next contest of World War II strategy and tactics. All right, so we've got one squad of Ostromans and then an MG42 coming out here. So the beginnings here of a nice Ostrapan opening. You get the entrenching tools. Does the defensive doctrine also has that, right? I think that's true. You also get the supply drop, which is the biggest difference for me between the Ostrapan doctrine. Well, actually, it's the second biggest difference between the Ostrapan doctrine and the defensive doctrine. But this is massive, and we've seen it do awesome things, actually. 400 manpower is expensive, but you get some fuel, you get some munitions, you get an MG34, and you get a pack gun. So it's really weird, a weird call-in. I would like to see it because I feel like I don't fully understand how it affects Wehrmacht builds. You get the railway artillery, you get the artillery field officer, which are kind of... I mean, the artillery field officer we actually never see be amazing, but I want to see him be good. But apparently he is just kind of meh in the meta right now. But the biggest difference between the two, for my money, is that one of them has the Stug E and the other does not. And the Stug E is very good because it's cheap and it's powerful and it does a ton of damage, and it's actually quite hard for your allied opponent to kill a lot of the time. And that is a powerful package. We've seen it be powerful a lot on the channel. And it's especially good on these small maps, like Langriskaya, like Fehmarnville Approach, and here, Crossroads. So, I prefer the other Ostrapan Doctrine. I prefer Defensive Doctrine because it has the Stug E. And the Stug E is so powerful. Like, I actually don't like the Pack 43, and Defensive Doctrine has that. So it is testament to how much I like the Stug E that, you know, I'm prepared to accept some things that I don't really like on that commander, because the Stug E is just so great. But we're going to see whether the benefits provided by railway artillery, what is this called again? The supply drop, the artillery field officer, and the... we're going to see if those advantages are able to do something that Defensive Doctrine would not have done. Let's see what happens here as Wehrmacht navigates this game. So far looking pretty good, able to establish control over the midline of the map, connect up one of the fuels, look to harass the other. But we've already got Pathfinders here coming out. These are the INR Pathfinders. Got to respect the DPS on them. Whoa, a load of Garand rifles going to be coming in from the rear of these Ostrapan, who are now in a pretty bad way, surrounded by Americans. We're going to try and trade out for a bit of damage, but I don't know if that's recommended. He tries to get a fallback. The focus fire was decent there from the Americans for a second. But no danger of a squad wipe. The Ostrapan's going to be able to exfiltrate safely for now. The MG42 going to leave cover to come across here and try and support them. Don't know about that. Pioneer's actually setting up an S minefield on the south side of the map as well. That's quite nice. Really annoying. Ugh, that's annoying. Oh well. Probably going to have to get a metal detector then, because this is going to be a really annoying minefield. what are we seeing here? Defensive Doctrine gets trenches and concrete bunkers. Oh, and these are just trenches? Okay, fair enough. And the support ability gives 10 fuel. I mean, that's not nothing. 200 manpower for an uncrewed weapon. Well, you get a pack gun and an MG34. So... It's not super cheap, is it? But it's not super bad either. Yeah, it's 400 for both. Which, like, if you were just buying them, what is a pack gun these days? 280? Or is it 300? Oh, wait, or is it 320? How much is a pack gun? Somebody remind me. I can't actually check right now. 320 is 320. Okay. So a pack gun is 320. An MG34, let's call it like 240. So that's like 460 manpower's worth of stuff. But then if you call them in this way, you have to reinforce them. So that's going to be like... yeah, it works out about the same. Like, more or less. So if you need the pack gun and the MG34, it's a pretty good deal. You're not really saving any manpower, though. But it is... it's a nice way of getting them. And it's also quite nice because it's a way of getting that all-important Pack 40, which we've seen the importance of that demonstrated, because we saw Skeletron try to play without Pack 40s and get punished. That is the weakness of playing without Pack 40s. You just die to light tanks, usually. And we saw then Angry Dutchman sort of, you know, starkly contrast that by showing us what happens if you do build Pack guns, and it's much better. But this is a way of getting Pack guns in a timely fashion for just 3 command points without having to build the Lythe the Mechanized Company. So that is interesting, actually. That is fundamentally interesting. That is actually quite cool. So there actually may be some real tech to be saved here. I appreciate it's fragile because it's 400 manpower, so you cannot do this very often. And if you ever lose that pack gun, things start looking horrendous. But it is a way of getting a pack gun without Lythe the Mechanized Company, and that's rare. Anyway, Captain Tech is done, and the American Flak half-track is going to be coming out here. So we kind of need pack guns, like, now. And, I mean, this is at the moment looking like a Vermac player who is failing the pack gun at 7-minute test. That is the test, I reckon. If you need a pack gun really at 7 minutes, otherwise you can and will die to light vehicles. So, I mean, this Flak half-track just gets to kill all the Germans for a while. Nothing they can do about it unless it gets too close and gets fausted a bit, but even that is not fatal. So, this Flak half-track looks like problems. Yeah. I mean, the mental bookmark I always used to have as a Vermac player was to, like, just be okay with losing the game if I didn't have the option to get pack guns by the 7-minute mark in the game. If you don't have the option of a pack gun and it's 7 minutes into the game, it's kind of on you if you die to a T-70 or a Stuart. Like, that is your fault, isn't it? Let's be real. Yeah, that's how I always thought of it. So, Lythe the Mechanized Company is done. Pardon me. And a pack gun will come down onto the queue. So, Panzergrenadier and Griefen going to decline to save the manpower and just use this ability. Wants the ability to build more pack guns and possibly 222s and whatnot from that building as this game goes on. And that's fine. So, absolutely, very safely here. Going to go for the pack gun. Has the option to build it and so will not die in the end to this half track. There's going to be about 40 or 50 more seconds where this half-track just gets to work unimpeded, mowing down Germans, and then we'll be able to stabilize substantially, I think, for Panzergrenadier and Griefen, who's actually, despite this Flak half-track, been putting on quite a good display of pressure. a lot of Axis control over the midline of the map, which we're not super used to seeing against USF. Testament, perhaps, to the raw strength in the early game of the Ostrepan. Yo, what's up, Strumming Bird? Good to see you in chat, friend. This actually is looking okay for PGA. The pack gun is out. It can definitely get exploited. American infantry can kill it very quickly, and if the half track finds a nice angle, the half track will kill it in a heartbeat. So I think I prefer keeping it central and supported. It is all the way out here in west unsupported, so this is a bit of a... this could be a weakness or even a gift for the American player. The half track is nearby, but you've got no support for this pack gun. What am I seeing? Look at this pack gun. It's just solo holding the west flank. Wow. What the? Is this a bad rally? Uh-oh. Where is this pack gun going? This pack gun wants to be safely here. That's where it wants. Okay, he gives it another order. What is he doing with this pack gun? I'm a little bit worried for this pack gun, but whatever. There's fighting going on. So let's take a look at the fighting here. Flak half track. Going to be doing Flak half track things here. Chewing into this MG42. Was that another S minefield here? I believe it was. Wow, how is he setting up these S minefields? Nice stuff here. Vermax here just being properly annoying. PFC, our American player, having to respond here. And to be honest, given the strength of this infantry roster, it's not that big. It's not as big as we might be usually used to seeing from American forces, and even given that he has a flat half track, he's not really being able to control the field in the way that American players are used to, and that is reflected by the fact that we're at less than 10 minutes in and he's already hemorrhaged over 180 victory points. So a fantastic opener here for Wehrmacht, navigating this game very skillfully, to be honest, finding a lot of value against a strong American composition. I'm sort of amazed, to be honest, especially given that this was a flak half track game where the pack gun was just a little late. But it all looks fine, doesn't it? So paratroopers are going to come in to help redress the situation. USF there are going to be saving some manpower. This is PFC saving some manpower to get that done. Just made math and did I add 320 and 240 and end up with 460 and not 560? I can neither confirm, deny, or deny. Yeah, alright, you got me. You got me, Aki HQ. I did math live on stream and I'm usually good at that because my mental arithmetic is decent-ish. It's like, at least it exists, let's put it that way, which is quite novel in 2020. But yeah, I screwed it up. You're right. So you are saving some manpower. Thanks very much for setting me straight there, buddy. Nicely done. So okay, it's going to be a Pack Howie coming out as well here for PGA, and we have seen them dominate in recent times. This is clearly a safe choice. It costs 340 manpower, so it's even affordable. For how good it is, that's fine. I'm loving Pack Howies now. I'm ready to. I for one accept our new Pack Howitzer overlords. so yep, Pack Howitzers going to be blazing as this game goes on. Wow, chat's really lighting up a little bit. I'm having to read through. It's taking me a second here. Sorry, guys. Positive 80 manpower for 10 fuel and 30 munitions. Yeah, I mean, there are advantages, as well as having a tech-free access to a pack gun, which is interesting, to say the least. And also putting an MG34 onto Wehrmacht, which, like, you don't often see, so that's kind of cool. I mean, it's very similar to an MG42, I grant you, but it's still interesting. Oh, the pack gun rolls a miss! That was a crucial shot to roll a miss on there. Wasn't going to destroy the flak half track, but would have made it close. And that's a bit of miss there for PGA. American units here are going to break through and get the fuel as a Panzer IV comes onto the queue. So that's really nice. Yeah, that miss. Damn. They do not come with any crew, no. So you do have to recrew them. But I kind of factored in a little bit of cost for that. It's like about 80 manpower if you want to crew them both. They don't drop men in crates. You cannot FedEx your soldiers to the battlefield. Alright, so things beginning to look a bit better now for PFC, our American Panzergrenadier and Griffin. Able to deny, pardon me, fuel in the West, able to get American boots onto a couple of these victory points at long last. And that is desperately needed, actually. Wehrmacht still playing more or less a perfect game, insofar as they still have 500 unblemished tickets here. And 268 is getting perilously low for PFC, our American Panzergrenadier, to be on. So now there's a Panzer IV out, and that will be the Kingmaker for a little while here. Actually, the American player doesn't have an AT gun. Oh, hang on a second. Whoa, this Panzer IV is going to be gross. I thought he had an AT gun. He does not. Uh-oh, this Panzer IV could really flourish. He could poke in and find the flak half track. He could, yeah, and I was going to say the pack howitzer as well. Oh no. Oh dear. I mean, obviously we don't want to lose the flak half track. He's getting dackered by the coax. And he gets the flak half track. Could go for the ambulance as well, buddy. Is he gonna? He's not gonna. He's gonna play it safe. I respect that. The pintle mounted MG42 finishes up at just the right moment to start laying into this pack howitzer. And look at this. American forces being forced from the field. Just when it looked like we were extending our control and being able to get something done on the map. These rear Esch are still doing something, but it's not going to be enough. This Panzer IV redressing the balance of power substantially. No manpower, indeed, to get the to call in the AT gun just yet as well. So this Panzer IV looks strong for now. Major tech is finished, and there is a Zook on the Major, but I mean, one Zook does not a Panzer IV beat. So that's a problem. Yeah, Panzer IV looking great. Strummingbird, which guy is Asia Mint? Is this? It must be this one, right? So this is Asia Mint and PFC. All right, so this is some pretty high level stuff then. All right, thanks Strummingbird. Appreciate the info. Oh, Aki HQ. Yeah, I did see Iron Harvest. I've had my eye on that one for literally years. It looks amazing. I cannot wait for it. If it's If it's a good game, I will be so happy. So yeah, Iron Harvest, yeah, looks sick. What if World War II? What if a Panzer IV had legs? That is basically the premise for that game. Let's play Company of Heroes 2, but Panzer IVs have legs. Let's do it. I'm game. Yeah, so that game looks awesome. Goodness me. Alright, we get it. You're being blown apart by a Panzer IV, but stop crying like a girl. Pull yourself together, man. Just kidding. Girls are actually pretty hardcore. They don't really cry very much. Alright, Panzer Grenadier and Griffin continues to dominate in this game. Back establishes a double cap, American player hemorrhaging tickets once again. The Ostrepan base roster really sticking it to Americans. In fact, we see Ostrepan kind of seem to do really well against American forces, which I'm kind of unable to explain. Like, I get that Ostrepan are quite efficient in the very early stages against riflemen, but like, I feel like once the riflemen get some veterancy and certainly some weapon upgrades, they ought to really just deal with Ostrepan, but I mean, we just don't see that in games, and I'm not really sure why. Perhaps it's because this MG42 has been supporting them so well. Perhaps it's because this Panzer IV is now here, but I mean, at some point before now, I would have expected the American player to sort of start looking really mean out on the field, because these riflemen are like brutes, but that's actually just not happening. Still kind of fighting on the doorstep of the base here is PFC. So that's really rough. Asia Mint is the American. Oh, Asia Mint, you're confusing. What? Really? So Asia Mint's Steam profile has PFC in the URL. Good God, that's annoying to deal with. Thanks, Asia Mint. Oh, well, cool. Yeah, that's not helpful. But anyway, whatever. Clearly, we're dealing with a high-level game, and that's all I care about. So that's fine. Wow, so, okay, what do we do as the American player here? We desperately need an answer for this Panzer IV, and we've got the beginnings of one in this M1AT gun. We want to spend our fuel, but at the moment we're being pressured so hard that it's being difficult to accumulate the manpower. How much is a Jackson? 145 fuel. A Sherman feels pretty bad here, because the Panzer IV is pretty good against a Sherman, and there's already a pack gun. And like, if you get tagged by a Faust once, you probably lose the Sherman. Oh, he is going to go for a Sherman. I was going to say, the thing about Shermans is they are affordable, and they are not bad. But this Sherman, oh god, he gets cut off as well. Oh no, and oh no, Wehrmacht is going to get double fuel. I reckon the American player is almost dead. Like, this is, I mean, this game's still alive a bit, but how do you break out from under this? This Panzer IV is just being so profitable. And the Axis army is just flexing right now, finding so much value. Bundle grenade! That was a nice attempt, but doesn't quite connect. And, I mean, look at the state of this minimap. Or this tactical map here. Jesus. Oof. A lot of work to do here for our American player, who may or may not be Asia Mint, it turns out, in the end. It's like he's wearing three layers of masks, and every time I pull one off, and I'm just like, aha! It was you, PFC, this whole time! And then I'm like, there's like another mask, and he like pulls that one off, and he's like, no, it was me, Asia Mint! He's gonna pull it off, and then there's gonna be like Love Nest or Helping Hands or someone underneath there. So, okay, we got the Sherman on the field. We've got the Sherman on the field here, and oh my god, these Panzer Grenadiers just sowing havoc though already. Rifleman with Zooks get into a building, but that building is so low, he loses the Rifleman! And we just can't afford to be replacing core infantry, man. We have no opportunity to be replacing this core infantry. That was crucial. That was a risky move to put them in that building. Now the Panzer IV is going to be able to fight the Sherman with no support. In fact, this is just a dead Sherman. There's a pack gun, there's Fausts, this game! Yikes! And that is game! Whoa. Sick. This German Panzer Grenadier and Griffin, who is not Asia Mint, looking dominating there. And I've been thinking about this for a while, but are Wehrmacht better than OKW right now? I mean, that's not even that controversial of a question. They're definitely better. Like, I think everyone knows. Everyone knows they're better. But like, wow, Wehrmacht's better than OKW. That's crazy. That's crazy. OKW are supposed to be the good Axis faction, not Wehrmacht. What is this madness? I don't even know what I'm doing anymore. Like, what? Okay. So it looks like let me show you what games we've got here on the ladder. See what you guys think. Does Co have pro players? Not really. It used to a little bit ish, but it's unfortunately there's just not enough money to be made in the game. I mean, it is quite an old RTS, to be honest. So here are the games that we have. We've got Artem Sex God, who, let's just see if we can glean anything else about this guy. No, not really. We've got Artem Sex God and this who is Asia Mint on Crossroads Winter. So once again, Asia Mint as USF against Vermacht on Crossroads Winter. We have the opportunity to watch that. We also have game two, Jukes QE, who I've cast quite a few times, versus Scoped on Lost Glider. And do we have anything else interesting? Not especially. So I feel like we should probably jump into the Asia Mint game. That is likely to be better. And it also starts in just 3 minutes rather than six. So yeah, that's got to be the one. We're going to jump into this one. Was that Kimbo in the picture? I don't know. I'm afraid I wouldn't recognize that. A game. Ostrup and Strats are OP. Wow, hot take, Strumming Bird. Maybe. The thing is, Vermacht as a faction are balanced around not having access to a conscript-like unit, and Ostrupen are a conscript-like unit that is available for less than the price of conscripts at the very start of the game. Now, they are worse than conscripts, so I think that they are priced accordingly. Are they broken? I don't think so. I really don't think they're broken, but I don't think that allied players are respecting them enough. I think if you start seeing Ostrupen out of your opponent, you need more machine guns for a start. And there are other adaptations to play, which I think allied players probably need to start making. But I'm slightly embarrassed by the fact that I actually can't recommend what they might be yet. So, all right, we've got a little bit of time before this game begins. So, now what I was actually going to do, although I still haven't really had time to think about it because work's actually been quite busy this last couple of days and I've had other commitments and I'm actually going away this weekend as well, so I've been like packing and doing other stuff. What I was going to try and do is do some evening streams, but at the moment the schedule for next week still looks the same. Monday, Wednesday and Friday, Midday Magpie, coming at you guys, 1100 hours GMT. You can catch it here, twitch.tv/magpie842 live, and you can find the VODs at youtube.com/magpie842. So yeah, that's what we're doing. That's what we're streaming. I'm going to try to do some evening streams next week because if we cast in the evening, there's a really good chance that the American players will be on, or more of them will be awake. So it's a chance to engage with the American players, which would be really fun. Cast some new guys. It'll also be a chance to let the American fan base tune in live on the Twitch TV. Lol, American fan base, as though I've got one of those. But there are probably some people in America who watch and enjoy. So yeah, give them a chance to tune in and catch some live stuff. So yeah. Oh. The game's even loaded in. That was perfectly timed. There we go. Let's get back in. I imagine on Monday I'll have had a decent enough chance to think about exactly when to do the evening streams, and I'll announce the sort of times and when I'm going to be doing those. So yeah, stay tuned for that. Of course, another thing that we're doing at the moment, whilst we have a moment here just to talk about stuff, is I'm starting the streams usually like a little bit early, just with me just playing a video game in the background so people can just log into the Twitch channel and just kind of hang out and chat. And I'll be active in chat, but I probably won't have the mic on to save my voice. But it's just going to be me playing some Magic or whatever game I feel like playing in the morning, maybe playing some Company of Heroes 2, maybe playing some Command & Conquer Remastered, whatever. But if you want to see Magpie actually playing games, just tune in like just half an hour or a bit before and you'll probably catch me on there. I just thought it would be a fun thing to do just so that I can kind of get used to playing games on the channel and just engage like in chat with people who are tuning in and just get the viewer numbers up to like a couple of people just like before the Midday Magpie game casting actually begins in earnest. So yeah, we're just experimenting with that at the moment. Also, check out below the Twitch channel, everyone. There's like some cool panels down there and stuff which are on the go now. So there's like a little Twitter feed there. You can follow me at MagpieCaster if Twitter's your thing. Just some other useful links and information down there as well. We're getting there. We're moving towards having a like semi well put together Twitch channel. It's happening. It is happening. I'm learning as I go and it's exciting. I'm having a lot of fun with it. it just balls out of control into multiple Panzer Grenadiers with Tech 3 and the option of very decisive light vehicles early on. I'm not gonna lie, Ostrobin seem to have a really good matchup against Americans, and I don't actually understand why. They have a good matchup against Tommies as well, and they kind of do have a good matchup against Conscripts, don't they? I just think Allied players need to build more machine guns early on. Allied players are not in the habit of building machine guns early on because they've never really had to. Wow, sorry, a feather just blew in through my window. But I think Allied players just need to get in the habit of building machine guns early on. Ostrobin are really bad against machine guns. If your opponent is doing Ostrobin builds, they very often do not have the access to a mortar. So I think early machine guns is good. That's what I think. Ah, come on, mouse. All right, Rifleman here going to get the overrun onto these Grenadiers. That's really nice. And the MP40 toting Pioneers are going to feed in next, but it's not going to be enough. There's just too much Grand Fire coming in here. Wow. He's actually messing around with the fallback path on these Pioneers. That's so low. That's a squad wipeable squad. Oh, God. That should be a squad wipe. Oh, God. That is such a brutal start. First Artem Sex God here, off to a rough start. I know I haven't introduced these two players, but the action was already underway, so we were focusing on that. No, Artem, no, we're just feeding in more Grenadiers. This is not profitable. This is a 3 versus 8 here. You're not going to get much value for your men there. pardon me. That's right, yeah. So spawning in the south here as the Wehrmacht German infantry forces. It's going to be first Artem Sex God. And spawning in the north, playing as the United States forces. It's going to be first Panzergrenadier and Griffin, who we are pretty sure is Asia Mint, although there may be more masks to be revealed. So that's who we've got. I'm going to be calling them by their screen names because that makes casting and viewing easy on everybody. So yeah, this is going to be Artem and PGA from now on, even though I appreciate that this is definitely not the real PGA. To be honest, I don't even know how to identify the real PGA. Does he even still play this game anymore? I couldn't tell you. Why stay in trade with the Grenadier squad versus the two riflemen? No idea, A-game. It didn't look good, did it? Yeah, I would have handled that differently. I don't know. Maybe his phone went off and he had to check his texts. Alright, so it's going to be Captain Tech again here. So PFC basically sticking to the previous build and probably feeling a lot better about life, having already taken a squad wipe and not seeing any Ostrobin on the other side. Yeah, Strongbird, I just keep thinking about your comment about Ostrobin being OP, and like, I don't think that they're OP. I really don't think that they're a problem, because we're not seeing them every game. By far, they're still the minority of games. And they're not warping the meta. And those are usually the signs of something that's OP. It might be that they do start doing that. It might be that they do become the majority of games and they do start warping the meta. And at that point, I'd be happy to reconsider. But at the moment, I don't... Although they are definitely good, and they give Wehrmacht something that Wehrmacht desperately want, and that's why they're so powerful, I still don't feel like they're actually OP. Like, if you look at Ostrobin, like, you shouldn't be losing because that squad is on the battlefield. I don't think. I just don't feel like they are overpowered. But I'm definitely asterisk. Magpie does not have a full understanding of the situation here. That is just my feeling right now, and I definitely need to think about it more and see more games. They're definitely very good, but there's nothing wrong with very good units. He wants the 5-man Gren spam. Yeah, man. I mean, what is it with German players and going for German infantry doctrine these days? I mean, again, German infantry doctrine is off to a poor start here. Here's what I think about German infantry, right? Clearly, German infantry doctrine is really good, or it provides a lot of power for the first... Okay, he's just going to GG. German infantry doctrine... What is with players just leaving games at the moment? German infantry doctrine provides a lot of power really early on, doesn't it? It's really good, because you get 5-man squads, get G43s, your Grenadiers are really good, and we see it gain a lot of momentum when it goes to plan in the early game. But it is heavily munitions-dependent. So we see players who want to play German infantry pick it right at the start of the game. I would say to those players... Wait 3 minutes. or 4 minutes maybe, and then assess, have I had the good munitions income I need to properly support a German infantry doctrine pick? Because if you don't, the games look like that. Like, you know, and it's okay. You can't really buy the German infantry leader upgrades for a couple of minutes anyway. So just wait and see. Did you get the munitions control you need to support that doctrine? If not, choose another doctrine. Like, or wait a little bit further and then assess again in two or three more minutes. Do I have the munitions to support German infantry doctrine? Or is it time to, you know, change it up? We've got a rematch here. That's interesting. We're going to watch that rematch. Yeah. Oh, we've got Elpern versus Hireling. Again, that was a good game. All right, guys, I need your help here in chat. Type one in chat for the game on Crossing in the Woods featuring PGA versus Asia Mint. Type two in chat for the Faymonville Approach game featuring Elpern and Hireling. So one in chat for Crossing in the Woods, two in chat for Faymonville Approach. Let me know what you guys want to watch, because these are probably both going to be great games. And I kind of want to see the rematch between Elpern and Hireling, if I'm honest, because Elpern played a sick game earlier. So I feel like that's the one. Man, that's a tough choice. Yeah, this is why I need your help, guys. So, Strumming Bird, so we got one for the Asia Mint game on Crossing in the Woods. Need some more votes here, guys. Need some more votes. I would open up a poll, but I want to do this quickly, and it's a simple choice, so I can just keep a visual tally of this. Aki HQ chipping in, wants to see the Asia Mint game on Crossing. Okay. Nobody wants to see more Brumbars? Nobody wants to see Brumbars on Faymonville? Really? Come on, guys. Come on. It's democracy in action. Somebody else vote. All right, I'll give you guys like 15 more seconds to vote here. And then we're going to have to make a choice. As I hastily munch some blueberries, just to keep the blood sugar levels high. Well, okay then. It appears like all of two of you, now three, want to see the Crossing in the Woods game. Fair enough. I'm game for that. Let's see it. I hope that not Asia Mint PGA doesn't like just GG out the game though. That would be a shame. Maybe if he does, we can still hop in and catch the Elpern game. That would be cool. Alrighty. I think that there was a little bit of a timer on the start of this game. We're going to find out once it loads in. Oh yeah, cool. Only 30 seconds. Right, wicked. Okay. Cool. Crossing in the Woods. I do like Crossing in the Woods. I actually feel like Crossing in the Woods might be... like, it's definitely in the conversation for the best or, like, most balanced map in the game. Insofar as it's not super small, but it's also not super big. And I feel like almost any playstyle can flourish on this map. And I think that's really cool. That feels good from a balanced perspective. Okay, spawning in the north, playing as the Ostrapan Doctrine Axis Forces is going to be Panzergrenadier and Griffin. And spawning in the south, playing as... oh no, yeah, it wasn't that game. Okay, yeah, sorry. And spawning in the south, playing as the American Forces, it's going to be Asia Mint, but who I'm just going to call American or like USF. Because they've got the same screen name. Thanks, guys. Yeah, of course, it wasn't this match where the Axis player quit suddenly. This was the match where the Axis player like just dominated Asia Mint. So, okay, Asia Mint here, out in with a chance for redemption, a chance to level the scoreline in this sort of, if you want to call it a series between these two players. Game two here, getting underway. Ostrapan at the ready, the subject of some discussion on the channel here recently, and we'll get another opportunity to examine the effectiveness, value, and power of the Ostrapan unit as this game unfolds. Going up to two Ostrapan here. They do, of course, only cost 200 manpower. Broken! Broken! Nah, seriously, though. Also Aki HQ with a super interesting comment in chat. I feel like 3 out of 22 people voting is one of the best representations of democracy in real life. You're not wrong. You're not wrong. Democracy is sick and unwell and ill. And actually, you know what? I think a lot of people at the moment feel like democracy is sick and unwell, because look at England. Look what's happening. Look at Boris Johnson, for God's sake. Look at America and Donald Trump. Look at what's going on, you know? But I have a sneaking suspicion that this is just what democracy looks like in the modern world. Democracy was an idea thought up by the Greeks, I think, initially, a long time ago, when the world looked very different. And in those times, you could meaningfully bring a community together and vote democratically for a decent outcome. Now, what we see in the present world today, labelled with the same word democracy, is so far removed from that, it is almost nonsensical that they're called the same thing. It's ridiculous. I understand that the principle is the same, but we have this horrendous monster called the media, which enables people with the most money to decide how people vote. And when you let that happen, then people like Donald Trump get into power. I'm sorry, I don't normally talk about politics, but it's happening right now on the channel, and you know, there's not a lot else going on in this game, so I'm going to talk about it. You know, if you let people influence your democracy using modern tools funded by money, you are literally letting your enemies choose the leader of your country. Okay, so if you let Russia and China choose who leads America, then the world looks like it does today. And they've also chosen Boris Johnson. Like, Boris Johnson has massive Chinese and Russian support, financially and otherwise. And he is suppressing documents. He is literally sitting on reports about that. It's so wrong, it makes me angry. But that's how democracy looks like in this day and age, and that is why I would humbly submit that actually, as a species, we need to let go of democracy. It doesn't work anymore. That's what I think. So there we go. Yeah, careful, Magpie talking politics is bad. Yeah, I know, absolutely. Yeah, this is not the place to be talking politics, and it's why I never do it. This is a place to hang out and laugh and have fun about Company of Heroes 2 and RTS video games. And that is all I really want to do. But the topic of democracy came up and I couldn't help. Ah, the words just spilled from my mouth before I knew what was going on. So there we go. That's geopolitical influence rather than democracy, my last point, Magpie. Yeah, sure, but I mean, I don't think you can separate them, so. Yeah, democracy isn't the problem, money is the problem. Again, you can't separate them, but I mean, you're not wrong, A-Game, you are not wrong. So, looks like we're doing typical Ostrobin stuff here. Three squads of Ostrobin, MG42 on support. Panzergrenadier is going to be coming out here to provide what the Ostrobin cannot in terms of core infantry units. And, you know what, actually? Ostrobin are increasingly powerful because in the modern age, Panzergrenadiers do not come from the Life the Mechanized Company. Panzergrenadiers are available immediately from the Wehrmacht HQ. That is actually huge, not for Panzergrenadiers, but for Ostrobin, isn't it? Because Panzergrenadiers basically do all the thing Ostrobins don't. And if you have Panzergrenadiers and Ostrobins, you have a fantastic core infantry roster. You support that with good machine guns and weapon teams, and you are set. Like, that is all the ingredients you need. So it is actually perhaps less to do with Ostrobins being what they are, and perhaps more to do with Panzergrenadiers being available from the HQ building independently of tech, that enables Ostrobin to go and do what they do. I don't know if that's accurate or not, but it feels like it's true. Yeah, the strength of Ostrobin is the 3-minute 30 Panzergrenadier. Perhaps so, yeah. Because I'm a big believer of having expendable, screening, ablative units, and then having units that actually do stuff behind them. And then, because you have both... Whoa, the S minefield in a great position. Whew, nearly got a squad wipe there. And Asia Mint, again, having difficulty at the hands of this Wehrmacht player. What was I saying before that? I got completely distracted. I was definitely saying something. It doesn't happen often, but I just totally forgot what I was talking about before that minefield started blowing up dudes. Oh yeah, that's right. Yeah. So I think it's really good having ablative infantry and then strong infantry behind that can deal good DPS and can push and have more utility. And then you insulate and protect them with your Ostrobin. And like, pretty much any time there is a tactical decision-making environment, that is a synergy that I will always look for. For example, you guys might not know, But I actually play Warhammer, and I have done for a very long time. I play a lot of Warhammer, actually. I play Warhammer 40,000, to be precise. And whenever I'm looking at choosing an army, I start with, before I choose anything else about the army, I decide what are going to be my chaff units. What are going to be the expendable grunts who are going to be soaking up the damage so that the rest of the army can do their stuff? Oh! Bundaroo grenade! Gonna destroy that captain squad. Jesus Christ, Asia Mint up against it once again here. But yeah, the first thing I do when I put together a Warhammer 40k list is I decide what's going to be my chaff infantry. Look at those Ostrapan trading equally 2v1. What the hell? They're legit combat units. Yeah, they're right. I mean, infantry with rifles are good. Conscripts are good. Ostrapan are good. Don't nerf Ostrapan. I like Ostrapan. All right, so the flak half track overextends here though, gets tagged by a Panzerfaust and then hosed with an MG42. It may be able to limp away here. We're gonna see, but that was an overextension. Oh God. Say what you like about Ostrapan, but how good is this Vermac player at putting S minefields in great positions? We saw it on Crossroad. We're seeing it again on Crossing in the Woods. Oh my God. I will say this. It feels odd to me that Ostrapan have Panzerfausts. I don't think Ostrapan should have Panzerfausts. Perhaps. It has always felt strange to me that Ostrapan just have Panzerfausts. And you don't need to research them. It's not like anti-vehicle grenades. They just have them. Well, you do need to have like Battle Phase 1, don't you? But I mean, yeah. Not sure about them having Panzerfausts. Yeah, who is this guy? I don't know. He is slaying it on the ladder, and apparently he's slaying it against Asia Mint, who is no slouch. So, yeah. Crazy stuff. Lock the Panzerfaust behind Vet 2 or 3 and we're good? Yeah, sure, that's a good suggestion. I think you could even lock it behind Vet 1 and things would be significantly better. But, yeah. That's a really good idea, actually, Aki HQ. That is a really good way of slightly altering the way that Ostrapan affect the dynamic of the game, but without actually changing any of the numbers or the sort of actual brute force of that unit. So, yeah, I like that. Looks like the game on Faymonville Approach with Elpern has ended. So, no chance to jump into that, but we're going to jump into another. These have been short games today. Short game. So looks like we got Artem Sex God versus Jimmy 890 on Crossroad. That's going to be Vermac versus USF again. Or another game on Crossroads, Vermac versus USF again. Insane IVI and I am nice person. I feel like we're just going to jump into this one. Yeah. Well, I mean, it's not like we really got to see a very good Crossing in the Wood game there, was it? Who's this? Nope, no clues given here. I'm going to jump into the Crossroad game though because it's got a few more people watching and I'm more familiar with these players, so yeah. Yeah, so, oh, Ruka LCL Bulat. Welcome to the chat there, friend. I don't think I've seen you around here before. PGA is a very well-known player, but that is not PGA. That's just someone using the PGA screen. This PGA screen name. So yeah, a lot of people seem to be impersonating PGA at the moment for reasons that I don't fully understand. And it's making it very confusing to cast. okay. Alright, spawning in the north as the Vermac pieces, it is going to be first Artem Sex God. And spawning in the south as the USF forces, it is Hoy's Jimmy 890, and we have actually not... American forces are having a tough time against Vermax, it seems, at the moment. It's going to be Armor Company? No, Mechanized Company. I knew it was wrong as soon as I said it. But anyway, yeah, it's going to be Mechanized Company. And German Infantry, again. All right, German Infantry. The bar is pretty high, German Infantry. You have to outperform the Ostrapan builds in the first 15 minutes of the game. Impress me. And once again, I'm going to say... We've seen the German player pick this commander before they know whether they have the munitions to support it. I think that's a mistake. I think you need to make a decision around about 2 or 3 minutes whether you want to choose this commander or choose another one or wait and then make another decision in 4 minutes. at the 4 or 5 minute mark, because you just don't know if you're going to be able to control the munitions point and have the income you need for the German infantry plan to look good in the first 10 or 15 minutes of the game. You don't know that yet, but you've already committed, so I think that's a mistake, if I'm honest. Oh, infantry doctrine, USF win. Well, not yet they don't, but I mean, I feel you. That was the real PGA. Oh, okay. All right, Ruka, what is that? Ruka Clanbalat. Coming in with some apparent knowledge that was the real PGA. I mean, that would explain the sick play. The thing with the infantry doctrine is that it mostly improves your basic tools to be better, which is strong, but it's very dependent on how good you are with those. I agree. It improves your basic tools to be better. But how does it really improve those basic tools? Well, the veteran squad leader upgrade on grenadiers is one of the biggest things that we see people want from this commander, right? That's why we see triple grenadier, and it's why we see people go for the veteran squad leaders on the grenadiers. But what does that actually achieve? It addresses the weaknesses of the grenadiers in two ways. First, most importantly, it gives you more durability, more HP, and a fifth model. That's massive for Vermax. That's huge, because Vermax don't normally get that kind of stuff. Then it also increases your DPS. That is a secondary, because grenadiers can increase their DPS in various other ways. And it's nice, it's important to have, and it lets you compete with riflemen and stuff, but it's not like the most important bit. And here's the thing, if you compare it to Ostrepan already have all of that durability built in straight away for a cheaper price without needing munitions. And they have Panzerfausts. And then you can just get the extra DPS from having Panzergrenadiers behind them. So I actually think that this veteran squad leader thing is kind of being totally misunderstood. I just think it's making your grenadiers into more expensive but worse Ostrepan. Kind of. I know that there's a lot more going on that I'm not talking about. I know that grenadiers do more things. They have rifle grenades, they do better DPS, and they scale better into the late game. That's also true. But the core thing that you're doing with this veteran squad upgrade is you are making grenadiers into better squads that are more durable, and I just think that's actually not as good as Ostrepan and Panzergrenadiers, the more I think about it. So there we go. That's Magpie's take on that scenario. No, we never see the Panzergren support package. We do from time to time. I suppose you can also put the veteran squad leader on Pioneers. Yep, you're not wrong, but we never see that. It's just never seen. Like, it's only rarely seen later on in the game when there's just a surplus of munitions. And the reason being, oh, it's only 30 munitions. All right, I take it back. Well, maybe players should be using that more often. I didn't realize it was only 30. I thought it was like 45 or something. That's not bad. Our opponents are seizing a sector. That is actually true. Yeah, you don't actually often see a lot of rifle grenades if you are buying squad leader upgrades, do you? Very good point. Certainly not in the early stages of the game where rifle grenades are most pivotal. So that's interesting for sure. Nice point. It usually is quite strong to make your engineers repair faster, Emma Duranke, but the thing is, Wehrmacht Pioneers are only 200 manpower for a squad anyway, so if repair speed is being a problem, you usually just buy another Pioneer squad, and they're useful to have around anyway. So I don't feel like that's a problem for Wehrmacht. They can just buy another squad, usually, if they need faster repairs. You hate rifle grenades? Yeah, rifle grenades are a real bitch. They're one of the very few grenade type abilities that have no HUD type warning. You have to see that animation starting. If you don't see the animation starting, it's usually too late. So it's very stressful to play against, I grant you. Oh, Strumming Bird, is that true? So you can have the 5-man upgrade and have the Flamer and the Sweeper, is that true? Oh, it's ore. Okay. Yeah, that makes sense. Okay, yeah, so you can have the 5-man and a flamethrower, or you can have the 5-man and a metal sweeper. Alright, that's cool. I dig it. So we're going to have a 2-2-2 coming out here for Sex God. Going to be laying into these... Oh, that is the cavalry riflemen coming out. We don't often see them. That's interesting. I don't know that cavalry riflemen are especially a good idea against German infantry doctrine, although to be fair, the American player has actually seen no tells that that's the doctrine that they're up against yet, so... How much are these boys? 280 manpower. Have they got Tommy guns? Yeah. Are the Tommy guns an upgrade that you had to buy? Yeah. Tommy gun is a 45 caliber? Jesus, I never knew that. Really? Christ. And as we're used to seeing on Crossroads, it's going to be Captain Tech into AA half-track.
Our supply line just got cut off.
The five-man missile sweeper is just free sweeping with no DPS loss. Yeah, I mean, that does seem pretty cool. Yeah, German infantry doctrine is a really tough one to assess because it does so many good things. And they aren't just incidentally good things, they're not just value. They apply value to some of the places where Wehrmacht need it the most. So it, on paper, it looks like such a good commander. It really does. But I just don't think it pans out in practice because of how the Allied factions work and because of the alternatives available, like Ostrapan. So, yeah. German infantry doctrine is a difficult one to assess at the moment. I think that's true. But certainly in the games I've cast, its win rate has been abysmal, and that can't be good. And I realise that's a very small sample size, so what do I know, essentially? But, like, it doesn't seem good, does it? The impact of the commander being harder to dex because it's tied to the basic tools. I mean, yeah, interesting point, Ibdaranki, sure. But if the impact is harder to detect because it's on the basic tools, I mean, there are other commanders that affect your basic tools in more meaningful ways, so I don't know. It's just difficult. I'm open to being wrong. Double 222s, Vi is Vi hundreds, Vi Svansish. Oh, sehr interessant. This is rare. Alright. That's a really interesting answer to Flak Half-Track, actually, isn't it? I think I quite like that. Now, the first veteran squad upgrades are coming down, and to be fair, Artem's Sex Squad has had quite good field control, great munitions income, so we are likely to see this German infantry doctrine start paying for itself here. Or at least we're likely to see the value that can be potentially provided by this commander, like, be realized, and that's good. Means that we might actually get to see a good game of Company of Heroes 2 as this one gets underway. Black Half-Track going to reveal itself here. The 222 just going to nose on in and put some damage on it. Hey there, buddy. It's going to put some holes in your Half-Track. What are you going to do? Okay, so worth noting, the cavalry riflemen do... Oh, wow. Did he just get a squad wipe in this building? Yeah, that was the Panzergrenadiers. Ouch. Okay, that's a rough loss there for the Wehrmacht player. Now the infantry roster is a little bit precarious. Two squads of cavalry riflemen. The hell am I seeing? Why is this a good thing? I don't understand. But okay, I'm open to seeing what Jimmy 890 is gonna put on here. This is weird. The 2222 is gonna break a load of infantry and push forwards here. Well, lag spike, but we're good. And when the flak half track is stationary and set up with good support, I don't think it's very risky to engage with the 222s. The cannon on the flak half track will make a mess of your scout cars. Got to be careful there. Flamethrower going to push forwards here, finds the captain. The 2222s going to come in for a fat dive here. They get tagged by. What was that? What? Anti-vehicle satchel charge? Oh. Well, that gamble didn't pay off for the Wehrmacht player. Okay, cavalry rifleman. I see you. Is that a Vet 1 ability? No? They can just use this. Okay, well, I'm living and learning. There we go. Infantry doctrine not looking strong today. Wow, that anti-vehicle satchel charge. I see they've been doing some sort of cross-training with the penal battalions. That is a useful thing to have, isn't it? All right, cool. I'm starting to be convinced by these cavalry riflemen. I did not realize that that was a thing they had access to be honest. And now we've got four squads of grenadiers, two with vet leaders, and a squad of panzer grenadiers trying to stem the tide against some very angry Americans who are pushing hard. Now, there is a pack gun, and that's going to help deal with the... Whoa, is that a glitch gun? Oh, look at that pack gun. Whoa. That pack gun... I hope that that pack gun is not stuck. He can move that pack gun, right? Please tell me he can move that pack gun. That's not stuck, is it? It's not moving, which is making me a bit worried. Hmm. That's unfortunate. He can move that pack gun. Okay, we're good. Okay, for a second I thought maybe that... Maybe the pack gun was glitched. All right, now he's all right. All right, we're cool. That was a bit weird, though. Severosaurus. You're a new customer, I think. New one there in chat. A new face. Good to see you there, friend. Welcome aboard.
We're losing a capture point.
Okay, you've been playing for 4 years and you just found out about the anti-vehicle satchel and the cavalry company guys. Cool. Well, then I don't feel too bad. Thanks, man. All right. Well, the Vermac player is going to make a pretty committed play for control of the west of the map here. That is for the Fatherland? Oh, no, it's Assault and Hold. Okay. Infantry squads are told to take and hold ground, increasing offensive ability and the speed at which they can seize territory. Increases accuracy and capture rate for 45 seconds for 70 munitions. Interesting ability. All right. All right, German infantry doctrine. I see you using munition dump abilities. Let's see what happens. Let's go. What do we... That is a fast capture speed. I will grant you that. That is a fast capture speed. 45 seconds is a long time to have it as well. So let's see if we can get some work done with these guys. All right, 50 cal in a nice position, but actually the grenadiers are going to slip around the arc. Nice, nice. All right, we've got 7 seconds left of this buff ability. If we can get some guys on mid, maybe. Nope, okay, well. I don't know if that was worth 70 munitions exactly right there, but I think that there is some power in that ability, so nice to see it used. It is very munitions hungry. You're right, Datton. All of these buttons, except for the 250 half-track, really, really, really want and need munitions. It's like you kind of you really need like 60 munitions per core infantry squad to really be getting the value out of this commander. If you can afford that, it's nice stuff, you know? It's really nice. Is it nice enough? Is it good enough to justify your whole commander pick? Just to make your grenadiers a bit better? Jury's out. We'll see. Certainly the frag bombing run is a really good munitions dump to have, though. Probably my favorite one that Vermac get, because it arrives so fast and it's so devastating. It stuns vehicles, which can be useful, and it will, as we've seen on the channel in recent times, it will just devastate and kill entire squads of infantry. And the reaction window for the allied player is so low. Like, that bombing run arrives very quickly. If you lose a 5-man grand squad, it hurts a lot. That is also true, yeah. But they are harder to lose, so it's okay. Medkits being used here. Nice to see Vermac players doing Vermac player stuff. Lieutenant Tech and Major Tech is here, so the tech tree actually complete for Jimmy 890 here. Is this a mortar half-track? Yeah. Wouldn't hate a mortar half-track, to be honest, but, I mean, now that Major Tech is done, we clearly want to be saving for something a bit more spicy, so probably going to be a Sherman. There are light anti-vehicle mines here. Huh. Nicely done there. No metal detector actually on the roster for the Axis player, so those ones are going to lurk a little while longer. Who can build those light anti-vehicle mines, then? Is that the cavalry rifleman as well? He's lost a cavalry rifleman squad. Good God, I'm so good at casting. No? Oh, what builds these light anti-vehicle mines? Somebody help me out. I'm so noob at this game. He loses the 50 cal there as well. Rear Esh build them. Okay. And Rear Esh can just always build them? So they can. For 10.
A capture point is being overrun.
Wow. Why don't we see American players use this more often? Huh. That's really interesting. Yeah, the USF is experiencing a ton of manpower bleed. Good point. Who is this? Astrogabe. Good to see you, friend. Yeah, They are experiencing a ton of manpower bleed, and look how small this roster is. The German infantry plan, despite the setbacks and some of the damage we've seen, the 2222s going down for kind of nothing, and the Panzergrenz getting leveled in a building, despite that damage, and no MG42 as well. Geez, so brave. And look at this, he puts an LMG42 on one of the Grenadier squads. Interesting. I think I really like that, because you can hide that behind you've got that kind of ablative wall of five-man squads, and then you've got the DPSE but fragile four-man squad with the LMG-42 behind. I like this. Cavalry Rifleman, though, going to lurk behind this tree and get a really nice engage. Going to pick off the wounded... Nope, okay. I thought they were going to pick off the fragile squad, but they just have to fall back. Too much DPS. Those Grenadiers taking names. Large American offensive going on. Pardon me. Over in this side of the map. So, doing some good work over here is Jimmy890. The flak half track still blazing away. But this American roster is tiny, and he was compelled to spend the manpower on the fuel to make use of this early... to make use of the major tech. It's not super early. So there's going to be a Sherman coming out. Panzer IV is also here. But yeah, look at this Wehrmacht player trying to play with no MG42. That's super brave.
A capture point is under attack.
Can you guys hear that on the mic? It is so windy. I literally have to close my window. Hang on. Sorry about that, guys. So windy out there. Wow. Okay, anyway. Let's try not to get too distracted by that. Alright. So we're in this kind of awkward mid-game where the American player has a Sherman and a ragtag bunch of surviving infantry. Artem Sex God is flexing, taking massive amounts of field control and going for the cutoff here. Not going to get it, so a nice defense for Jimmy890, but we desperately need more field control. Oh no, he loses another squad. What was that? He lost his one remaining rifleman squad? No, he lost the major. Oh, rough. Oh no. I mean, that could be game-ending damage, to be honest, because, like, the Sherman kind of will usually die to a Panzer IV, certainly with a pack gun on support, and all these Grenadiers with Panzerfausts. And, there's just not enough Americans here to contest this infantry roster. Somehow a 50 cal is going to be doing some capping here, but... Oh, this is just dire times. He's going for cavalry riflemen again. Surely we just need some riflemen here. I don't know about going for cavalry riflemen, because you need to get them close to really deal damage. And are you really going to get them close to this German infantry roster? I'm not sure. So he's going to keep investing in these cavalry riflemen. It's making me a little uneasy. But at least the roster is a little larger now. We still need more core infantry, to be honest. And I would love a pack howitzer as well.
The enemy is overrunning one of our capture points.
I think if we can somehow spare the manpower for a pack howitzer, that would be lovely. But, as chat has pointed out, the American manpower bleed has been really bad. Constantly having to replace losses and reinforce squads. And this American roster, the development has been severely slowed down by the amount of manpower bleed that we've been seeing.
We've got a rifle squad waiting for orders.
Okay, wow. I mean, some interesting discussion about knowledge of this game. It's true, knowledge of this game is a real art and a skill, because they change things so frequently, and the game's been out so long, so many things have been changed. And it is actually quite hard. I mean, nowhere in the game does it really tell you the important information. And that's a problem with Company of Heroes 2, which I've mentioned before. And I hope in Company of Heroes 3 there's like an encyclopedia mode where you can just go and look at all the numbers and figure out everything. Like an encyclopedia mode would be really useful. But anyway, rifle grenade comes through. Looks like Hoi Jimmy890 on top of it. That's pretty good. And is able to finally connect up a fuel and make some gains here. But... needs to address the victory points, starting to fall behind. 320 tickets to work with is decent. Oh no, we can't be losing the captain though. The Panzer IV wants it. He thinks about focusing the captain. He keeps changing target. Did you see that? He changed target a few times there. But eventually settles on the Sherman. Now this Panzer IV, where's the pack gun? The pack gun actually not in a position to support right now. Dozer Blade finishes on this Sherman. So that increases its HP pool, am I right? It reduces its speed but increases its HP pool, I think. How do I tell? Oh, here we go. Increases health and armor. Wow. Oh yeah, look at it. There we go. Gonna bounce a shot. pretty good advertisement for that increased armor. Okay, all right, this is an interesting upgrade then. Not often we see the Dozer upgrade. I mean, this has been a good day for Shermans, actually. We've seen the 105mm Bulldozer Sherman look really good on the channel today. And now we're getting to see the Dozer Blade upgrade, increasing the armor and the HP on this Sherman tank. 20 fuel, 50 manpower, so a fairly expensive upgrade, to be honest, but we'll see if it goes on to provide value. I'm keen to see what it does. Plus 200 armor, so 200 armor plus 80 extra HP. Strumming Bird, you are a madman. How do you get all this stuff? Yeah, A-Game making an interesting point that the way unit design is done at the moment means that there's almost no opportunity to get an encyclopedia, and I agree with you, it's a mess. In fact, Company of Heroes 2, the engine and the way it's always been operating, it kind of has always been a mess. It's not very well optimized. Although it is not an ugly game, it's still not very well optimized, and I get the feeling it's on a nuts and bolts level, it's kind of a mess. And I just hope that they prioritize for the next Company of Heroes having a clean engine. If we can have a clean engine that's well optimized, a tidy engine, I would prioritize that over having a pretty engine like any day. So yeah, that would be nice. Fingers crossed it's taken in mind for Company of Heroes 3. Yeah, absolutely. And I mean, you know, Relic and Sega must be aware that having the engine be this untidy has literally cost them money, like in terms of development time, in terms of support time, in terms of opportunity to do things with this game. It will have cost them money, so that's the way to make sure you change your behavior. If it's costing you money, it's probably going to change your behavior, because that's how humans work today. So yeah, we'll see. Connix calling for me to mod creative name. Yeah, I'm thinking about it. I probably am gonna. Dozer upgrade should increase the pop cap. Interesting. What's your basis for that thinking there, Pineapple? I'm not sure I follow. Hey, Sorava. Good to see you in chat there, friend. Wow, everybody's like reciting the armor values of tanks in chat. It's really interesting to see the numbers. Panzer IV has actually been consistently unable to penetrate the armor on this Sherman since the Bulldozer upgrade came down. So this is definitely looking productive, but now we're up to two Panzer IVs and a Stug G will be following. And you have to feel like with those tools, the Sherman's days will be numbered. But there's a second Sherman out. The Dozer upgrade is coming, so it's going to be the Dozer Brigade against this Panzer Battalion. We're going to have to see what happens here. Somehow Jimmy890 scraping together the fuel needed to get double Sherman, double Dozer upgrade. So the Dozer takes the Sherman up to 130 fuel. So that is reason. I mean, that is actually more fuel than these Panzer IVs at that point. So that's interesting. And I think the Stug G will not be that challenged to penetrate these tanks, even with the Dozer blade. But I could be wrong. It's not an interaction I've seen before, so I want to see. We are again seeing Assault and Hold come down for Sex God here. These Grenadiers going to make a determined push, and look at how quick they're going to cut this off. That's cool. That's value. I like this. All right. So Assault and Hold looking decent. And, you know, it's amazing what you can do with German infantry doctrine if you get the munitions to back it up. And it's also amazing what you can do against a USF player who's still just... Oh, no, he's lost his... lost another cavalry rifleman squad. And I just feel like Hoi Jimmy 890 is just spinning his wheels trying to get an infantry composition that's capable and then hold on to it. And I appreciate it. That's really tough. Look how much dangerous German stuff there is everywhere. But... Yeah, in this game, it's not coming together for the German infantry. Sorry, for the American infantry lineup, and it's very hard to play Americans without what they depend upon most—their great infantry. So anyway, here comes the Stug. Yeah, and that's penetrating through the front. I reckon it should be fairly consistently doing that. A capture point is under attack. And if we crack the tack, we can see the situation here. I mean, more cavalry riflemen coming in. Okay. Are we throwing good money after bad? I don't know. So, yeah, we're back up to two squads of cavalry riflemen with two officers. There's still a machine gun to support them. We still have two Shermans. This is not over, but the scoreline is becoming an issue. 219, 217 tickets bleeding out pretty rapidly. And it's just looking real tough to be an American out here on this battlefield. The German infantry doctrine roster has been achieved. We have three squads of veteran squad leader, three-star infantry here, and they are out there doing assault and hold, and you know, this is the German infantry dream. We've made it here, people. We've made it. And if Arsum 6 squad doesn't close this game out, something will have had to have gone horribly wrong, I feel, because we're at double Panzer IV with a Stug on support. That all looks great. Probably time to go ahead and get Battle Phase 3 next. Oh yeah, we already have it. Probably time to throw down the Schwerpanzer HQ to get the advantages of the cheaper reinforces and the quicker captures. I wonder if that stacks with Assault and Hold for an incredibly quick cap. That would be pretty, pretty cool. you know, Hoi Jimmy 890 faced with the monumental task of trying to get something done against this really intimidating Axis army with only a very, very limited American toolkit here. Two Shermans will be firefighting as best they can. The Stug coming in a bit deep, perhaps risky, but it's going to back away eventually. The other Panzer IV just being active, just winning the other flank. You have to keep the Shermans together, really, or else they'll get mobbed. But if you keep the Shermans together, it basically means that the Axis player will always be winning one flank. So the triple cap has been established. The bleed rate is becoming super real. The Axis player is about to secure double fuel. And I think the writing may be on the wall here for Jimmy 890. This has been a rough game for sure. And I appreciate the spirit that they're displaying and continuing to fight and putting up a good resistance even now against horrible odds. But this may be a little, this may be just too much. It's maybe too much here for Jimmy 890 to get done. It really should be too much. A comeback from this position would be insane. And Jimmy knows it. Gonna leave the game at that point. No way back. And I feel like that actually wasn't really a problem with the American teching or the American vehicles. They were looking pretty decent, to be honest, even against stiff Axis resistance. The problem was trying to hold this infantry roster together. Jimmy 890 suffering horrendous amounts of manpower bleed in terms of model losses and squad wipes. And that really was the telling tale. If you are unable to hold onto your core infantry, you basically always lose. And that really was the moral of this story. Now here's a question for you, chat. Was the German infantry doctrine any good there? So what I'm saying is, is that a game that was won because of German infantry doctrine, or would any German doctrine that is like providing value have done well there? I feel like even though that was a win for German infantry, was it a win because of German infantry? I don't know. I don't know about that. I don't know. I just feel in my gut that I'm a little bit, like, quite skeptical of this doctrine. It's very so-so. Yeah, the Grems wiped a few squads, but they wipe a few squads if they've got four men and LMG-42s anyway. So I'm like, I don't know. I don't know. Maybe I'm being too critical of this doctrine. Wow, amazingly enough, the scout cars managed to be relatively efficient. Oh, because they got so much vehicle damage. That's why that looks good. So there we go. That's going to conclude the stream for today. We've been up for just a little over 3 hours now, and my voice is unfortunately feeling the pain. An interesting clutch of games there, for sure. Just quickly checking. Yeah, all right. There's no super great-looking games there. Yeah, an interesting clutch of games there, for sure. I'm very glad to have seen a Brumbar game. We saw probably the real PGA do some really nice stuff, get a Brumbar and start wrecking. We saw Bulldozer Sherman, the 105mm flumpy one, like do really good. We saw Ostrepan Doctrine and some great discussion about Ostrepan and where they are in the meta, which is very interesting. And yeah, a really good clutch of games there. Absolutely. So, pardon me. Next stream will be on Monday, same time again, 1100 hours GMT. Then of course Wednesday and Friday, and on Monday I'll also announce if and when I'll be doing some evening streams next week so that we can cast some American players. That should be fun. So yeah, really looking forward to streaming next week. It's been a great week for the stream. The channel has grown massively. We've got alerts to work and we've gotten a lot of support and love. There's been some great discussion and just activity and energy coming from chat, and it's just been awesome. And I'm really enjoying this whole Twitch thing. Like, the more I learn, the more I seem to like it. So that's really good fun. Thank you very much, all of you, for joining me today and coming with me on my Twitch journey. And this, for now, until Monday, will be Magpie842 signing out. In fact, you know what? Let me just spend 2 minutes here to read through chat, because there was definitely a little bit that I missed. And also find someone find someone to host. Bear with me. Who are we going to host? Let's see who's playing. Alrighty, let's see. Company of Heroes 2. So we've got some Korean guy, Crossfire, Elpern. Oh, we could host Elpern because we really enjoyed that game. That seems fair. Oh, Stjindy as well. Stjindy has hosted us a few times for like a ton of viewers. We should host Stjindy. That is a really difficult Stjindy. There we go. That's how we sell that one. Thank you very much, A-Game. Really glad you enjoyed the stream. Cheers, Aki HQ. Thank you very much for the kind words. Yeah, we're going to see some Magpie play sometime for sure. Don't you worry about that. And yeah, thank you very much to everybody else for tuning in. Creative name, I'll probably mod you next time. Don't worry about it. Strumming Bird, thank you very much for having your knowledge. You have been the knowledge bomber. It's been really good. All right. We're going to raid Stjindy now. That's enough for me. Thank you very much, everybody. This for now. Magpie842 signing out.